Let's hear from Donald Trump, who isn't down with TPP, then Hillary.
Hillary Clinton and her campaign. Badly.
Kind of like him like that, even though it's an accident.
She has it completely backwards. Hillary Clinton unleashed a
trade war against the American worker when she supported one terrible deal after another, from NAFTA to China to South Korea. It doesn't matter. No matter where she went, the American worker was hurt. And you will be hurt worse than ever before if she becomes President of the United States. That I can tell you. A Trump administration will end that war by getting a fair deal for the American people and the American worker. The era of economic surrender will finally be over. It'll be over.
May I just put this on a loop? Just personally at home?
I can't guarantee it, because after me, they'll probably start doing it again. But we will have four.
They say plants grow faster and better when they just play Donald Trump.
And we'll never go back, and we'll make sure we never go back.
Plants have higher yields, and cornfields are now starting to play Donald Trump. I'm being sarcastic for the New York Times.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, actually, plants do grow faster when you let them listen to Donald Trump.
Thank you very much, everybody. I appreciate it.
Probably is true.
A new era of prosperity will finally begin. America will be independent once more. Independent once more.
Wow.
Doesn't that sound great?
Not run by foreign megabanks? That's racist.
Under a Trump presidency, the American worker will finally have a president who will protect them and fight for them.
By the way, folks, we don't normally carry a lot of Trump speeches because they were actually getting on the
news.
We
will stand up to trade cheating.
Now they're never playing them, so we're going to start playing large portions every day.
We will stand up to trade cheating. I'm going to withdraw the United States from the Trans-Pacific Partnership.
We got to elect him.
Which has not yet been ratified.
We need to paint Trump at the Sistine Chapel.
The Trans-Pacific Partnership is another disaster. Done and pushed by special interests.
I'm not always gay, but when I am, it's for
Donald Trump. Rape our country. Just a continuing rape of our country. That's what it is, too. It's a harsh word. It's a rape of our country. This is done by wealthy people that want to take advantage of us and that want to sign another partnership. So,
this is so key.
Hillary Clinton, not so long ago, said this is the gold standard of trade pacts. The gold standard. And she's down and saying, this is the gold standard. In fact, I saw it on television this morning.
You down with
the
TPP?
Gold standard. Then when I got involved and I started pointing out all the flaws, especially the fact that monetary manipulation, currency manipulation, which is a primary tool that other countries use, especially China, to destroy our companies and to take our business, okay? It's not properly addressed and practically not even discussed at all.
And he's forcing it in.
So it's fair to say that our economies are entwined, and we need to keep upping our game.
Hillary made me
both
gay.
Bilaterally and with partners across the region through agreements like the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP. Australia is a critical partner. This TPP sets the gold standard in trade agreements.
The gold standard in secret ripoffs for criminals like you.
Fair trade, the kind of environment that has the rule of law and a level playing field.
The rule of law.
And when negotiated, this agreement will cover 40% of the world's total trade.
It'll be a delicious screw job
on
the West.
Strong protections.
And exploit third world peoples to levels never before seen. I'm translating live for you. I have a, like in Star Trek, I can decipher the alien language for you and actually give you what they're really saying and meaning. We'll be back, folks. I'll stop with the satire, but I've got to have some gallows humor up front at the start of the broadcast because this is going to be a big one. By the way, if you ask for brownies on the menu, you will have the police called on you. Saying the word brownie is now racist. The police have been called. They have responded in Philly. Stay with us. You cannot make this up. I'm Alex Jones. InfoWars.com. Obama has come out in a statement and badmouthed populist movements in the United States and Europe. And that just made me think of Sunday, the German president coming out and saying the elites are not the problem, the populations are the problem. And then that made me think of one of the top people at the Council on Foreign Relations that was established in 1922 at Pratt House, New York, openly by British intelligence to establish a intelligence agency under a National Security Act that would create a silent dictatorship over the United States. That was effected finally in their main mission in 1947 with the National Security Act and the establishment of the Central Intelligence Agency. Merging that with the 1913 Private Federal Reserve, they had a secret shadow government and the control of currency and credit. The British Empire had reconquered the United States. The victory of the 1780s had been reversed. But let's be clear, that's not the British people that are our enemy. It was the British imperial shadow government model of Cecil Rhodes deployed and adopted here. So it was more of a merger of the British Empire into the United States, but the same management techniques, and then now a merger with the European system and their oligarchs to establish a eugenics-based world government. And that's why we have, if you're a TV viewer, look at the arrogance of this person's face and just this classic look. So many of these billionaires and elitists are inbred. They are mentally ill. They have a lot of genetic problems. I don't care if they're Jewish in background, German in background, Chinese in background, Japanese in background, Russian in background, Spanish in background. Their eyes normally don't point the same directions. It's just that's seen as a sign of elitism in England. If one eye points another direction, and I'm not being mean to folks that have that genetic disorder from interbreeding, the gypsies have that, the Romanovs have that a lot too. You're like, I don't have a lazy eye there. That's seen as if you have a lazy eye, you're in the best, private clubs. If you're wearing a tuxedo and got a lazy eye and like, and you can't even hardly talk, like, who are you with? What club? You're like, they'll just, oh, no, lordship, good lord, come out immediately. I mean, I'm not kidding, okay? I'm not joking. So, got an extra finger, you're all good lord. So that's what this is all about. In fact, the British royal family, even the BBC's reported, has another strand of DNA, not a double helix, but a triple helix, has a delicious little mutated something. They're not quite sure what it is, but the royalty is sure what it is and keeps that little antenna in the family. So get those transmissions, they believe. Now, continuing, CFR member calls on elites to rise up against ignorant masses. Wealthy heir to the Bloomingdale's chain sneers as populist voters who cherish values and tradition. And notice his eyes do not point the same direction. He's in the club. The psycho, interbred, nutcase club. It doesn't mean everybody whose eyes point different directions is like that. Okay, it can be from damage or car wrecks or whatever, but with these guys, it's all the same. I call it the little twinkle of El Diablo. Look at Zuckerberg. Everybody has the little twinkle of El Diablo. Continuing, in a column for Foreign Policy magazine, where they openly announce world government, how they're chemtrailing us and everything, how they run Al-Qaeda, they just write it like we're total idiots and just it doesn't even matter, because criminals always brag. But they tell you it's a greater good, and they're so intellectual, they understand the end justifies the means. In a column for Foreign Policy, I meant to cover this 3 days ago, I'm covering it now because it ties into everything. In a column for Foreign Policy magazine, Council on Foreign Relations member James Traub argues that the elite need to rise up, these are quotes, against the mindlessly angry, ignorant masses in order to prevent globalization from being derailed by the populist revolt that has led to the Brexit and the rise of DJT, or the centipede. That's one of Trump's nicknames that I'm most fond of on the internet. And then those that support Trump are known as baby centipedes. I've coined the term Trumpkins is what I prefer. My children are Trumpkins. I'm not really a Trumpkin. But continuing, citing, here, let me read in a fake Atlantic elitist accent that was affected by the 20s when British intelligence made it popular in early talkies when those first came out, so that you could really show you were in the in club you had to speak with a slight British accent, but that's what have mutated into a Thurston Howell III. Oh, Buffy, love it. Would you like to buy some mining stock, Gilligan? Perhaps some derivatives? Yeah, let me show you that I can talk like them. Yeah, let me talk just like he does. Concerned that today's citizen revolt, see, I can talk like them too, in the United States, Britain, and Europe, may upend politics as nothing else has in a lifetime, Traub notes that Britain and the Brexit was a, quote, utter repudiation of bankers and economics. No, of mega five banks above the law, tax exempt, that have diplomatic immunity, that openly are funding, taking our guns, taking our property, shutting down local banks. The head of the Texas Banking Association 4 years ago wrote a 19-page giant article that was in the Austin Business Journal. I happened to just see it sitting there, and I was at a restaurant waiting to pick up some food, and she goes, oh my God, did Alex Jones write this? And I found out it was in newspapers all over the state. And he was just saying, it's a global elite taking over. They're shutting down all the local banks. They're shutting down the credit unions. They're shutting down loans. They want to collapse in the economies. They can consolidate it. They're giving themselves the trillions in bailout money and not delivering it actually to the people so that we can loan it out. And then meanwhile, the average idiot thinks the bank down the street that's local or regional is their enemy when almost all of those are collapsing right now. But I digress. He just goes, they're just against civilization and economics. We're speaking of economics here, something you little people don't know anything about. Well, let me see. 68% of the first 2 years of bailout was in the tens of trillions, not 800 and something billion. And it was given, the vast majority, almost 70%, to foreign banks and still is secret to this day. And then almost none of it, less than 10%, look it up for yourself, has ever actually been put into the economy, into the people. That's how they stop too bad inflation. They go, oh, we're going to have unlimited free money for ourselves, but make sure that we don't spend it anywhere in the retail low-level market. You don't get any of this money. It might inflate things. So yachts and real estate for the super rich inflate, and that's where the inflation is, and that's why it's stratospheric. But don't worry, proletariat. We have confined it to luxury penthouses and 300-foot yachts and private floating cities and private airports and pleasure palaces and armored keeps, redoubts, fortresses, castles, or you can simply call them hideouts. Take your vaccines and drink your aspartame. There. Now there's a haze. Just go to sleepy there. In all our white papers, we say we put fluoride in the water to dumb you down, and we announce that we're in a war with you. But Pepsi for 1 year took aspartame out because of lawsuits and because no one was buying it. But they snuck it back in last week. Don't worry. Drift away. Enjoy the brain tumors and enjoy the baby flavoring. Now, they take baby flavoring and then synthesize it into a synthetic baby flavoring. But they test the baby flavoring with a DNA cue that is fresh baby. So, to be technical, your Pepsi and Pepsi products is baby flavoring, not babies, but tested by babies. But let me continue here. I'll be intellectual today and speak in this vernacular for you. How does that sound? Continuing. Citing the potential for a Trump to split the Republican Party, even if he does lose, and increasing unpopularity of France's socialist government, Traub argues, another billionaire for socialism, that establishment of political parties in major Western countries must combine forces to keep out the nationalist. That's a quote. We must combine forces to stop them. We claim we just rule you, and we're tax-exempt. And we do all these wonderful things like funding radical Islamists to come in, and then you don't like us. But look, I'm standing on the street in my photo, smiling arrogantly. And isn't that what it's... And these so-called elitists, they're a bunch of psychopaths and sociopaths, but they're not even that smart. They just have management systems that have been sputtering on for hundreds of years, dumbing everyone down and engaging in all this criminal activity and wrecking countries and wrecking economies so you can perch on top of them because you can't compete with prosperity. And then you misrepresent what we say about you, trash. And guys like this, Rothkopf and others, have been like, join us, Alex, you're smart. Come, you'll be very successful with us. And then later they just... You don't want to be with us? Because you go to Harvard and all these places and you work and work and work. And I guess you're from the right family and you work 18 hours a day for years in some law firm. And then finally they invite you to go play golf for them. Kind of like Judge Smales in Caddyshack. He says, how would you like to come by, huh, and mow my lawn? And then after you've done that for another 10 years or so, maybe you marry one of their, you know, innerbred, mentally ill daughters and put up with her crap. And then I guess you go in the steam room with dad and then, you know, service him, you know, with your father-in-law. And seriously, folks, then you go to a little satanic ritual. Then next you're at the mansion, you know, having some pedophile fun. And Jerry Sandusky drops by. And then you're in the club. And they say, young man, it's time to run you for Congress. That's right. We'll have you in 2 years. I'm just hypothetically talking about the whole genre of these people. Certainly not this guy. He's a wonderful person. You are the pretender. I will never surrender. All right, let me give you a smattering of the news. It's a big news day, obviously, and a lot of big guests joining us as well. We have the Secret Service agent who's valiantly exposed the bizarre behaviors and criminal behaviors going on inside the globalist infestation known as the White House. He says people need to know the real Hillary Clinton and how dangerous she really is. He calls her a dictator. That is coming up, Gary Byrne. We're working on getting Roger Stone on short notice. There's just so much stuff breaking on that front. I talked to some folks involved with the campaign, and then I'm able to bounce that off Stone. And he likes to be not pessimistic, but likes to really lowball things. And he confirmed to me when I talked to him on Sunday, this wasn't off the record, but he said he was going to wait till the polls started coming out. And sure enough, they don't really release their own internal polls. Hillary does that, or they have their friends do polls and then skew them, and then she has them released and claims that they're independent. The Trump people, of course, have Ron Paul's former pollster. He's a libertarian, and some other groups, and they're doing real polls. They really want to know real optics, what's going on. And what was it, three polls? He's basically margin of error, 3 points ahead, 2 points behind, basically dead heat. Several other big polls nationally. He is 7 to 10 points ahead. That was this Sunday, internal Trump polling. And I know there's some infighting reportedly inside there about the fact that they're not releasing these, but whatever reason they're not. And then, of course, I told you on Sunday that Trump, and I told you on Monday that Trump was in a dead heat or 7 to 10 points ahead. That's now, you notice, coming out in separate polls by Rasmussen, by Gallup, a bunch of others. Rasmussen poll, Trump pulls ahead of Hillary. The tables have turned. And every time he takes the gloves off and savages her, she goes down. Now, understand, folks, you're going to see polls out there with, you know, Jimmy Fallon or whoever having Hillary on going, man, congratulations, you're 15 points ahead. He might say she's 300 points ahead. And you're like, well, that's impossible. She can get 100% of the vote. She'd be in only 60% vote in national elections. That's impossible. That's my point. I mean, why not just have Jimmy Fallon or whoever just announce, oh, I hear you're 15 points ahead of that racist, bigot, homophobe Donald Trump. I mean, none of it's true. None of it's true. In fact, if you get down to brass tacks, he's economically conservative. He's very socially liberal, folks. That's the truth about Donald Trump. He's a nationalist. I want the states to decide social stuff, the people to decide social stuff. Quite frankly, it's important to me. But that's not overall a president's job. I mean, what they do personally in their life is an example, but it's the states, as Ron Paul's always said. So it's not on my radar. He's a very moral person, though, when it comes to courage, and God hates a coward. And so that's why I admire Donald Trump, but he is ahead in a lot of polls. And these are scientific polls, or he's in a dead heat. The tables have turned. Well, see, but that's a Rasmussen article. They haven't turned. He's been ahead of Hillary the whole time. You've heard the callers call in and you've seen the examples. Callers go, it's incredible. I saw a story and now I can't search for it about Hillary and her crimes. Google admits they're censoring. They've been caught doing it. Facebook admits they've been caught doing it. But people just can't believe it. They're like, Alex, they're censoring. Yes, I know. So we need to let everybody else know what's going on. But just tell other people it's an illusion to make you feel like if you're supporting Trump, you're a loser so that you maybe go, okay, well, I want to bet on a winner. It's a well-known phenomenon in football or other sports, hockey, where if a team is looking like it's going to go in the playoffs, suddenly they start selling more jerseys, more hats, selling more tickets, more hot dogs, more beer. But suddenly if they have a big upset and lose, well, people will just jump and stop wearing those jerseys and just go out and buy the other team's jerseys. They want to be associated with a winner. And yeah, it's kind of like if you're associated with a winning family or you're associated with a winning or your man married to a powerful woman or vice versa, then that matters. But being associated with a, quote, winning team, it's all just delusional. And it's the same thing with Hillary, because you're a chump if you vote for Hillary. You're an idiot. You're a moron. She's laughing at you. I mean, she is an absolute criminal, psychopathic dirtbag. Stay with us. But that's what human freedom is about. Being able to put yourself at risk, being able to go to the edge, that's where you expand your mind, expand your neurons. It's where you join, really, your people, your ancestors, in all the bold things they did. But we shouldn't risk our lives on just cheap thrills or fun. All of us are guilty of it at a certain extent. We're meant to have those instincts and those drives to dare greatly and to stand up against bad people. And it's the failure to face down these demons that has brought us to the state we're at now. And you see civilization, society drifting towards societal collapse and oblivion. Later in the broadcast, I'm not sure when, but I will air it. There is a special report that Rob Due took about 2-3 days to edit together with clips and documentation where I really break down the globalist plan to use food as a weapon and trigger a worldwide financial collapse to try to terrorize the population back into submission. And when you actually hear what the head of the EU says, and the deputy head, and the German chancellor, and the German president, and when you actually hear what the Council on Foreign Relations is saying, and Obama, when you see everything that they're pushing and everything that they're engaged in, it's amazing because they're actually saying. And we've got their quotes, we've got the articles, we've got the statements in the video. In fact, the video is now on Infowars.com. We can put it up on screen for TV viewers and I can give you the headline that I was going from memory and give you the actual headline. There it is. Globalists intend to use food as key weapon in world takeover. Yeah. That's not a sensational headline. That's really what they say they're doing. It's amazing. Look at these quotes out of the Council on Foreign Relations. Foreign Policy Magazine, where they talk about the Brexit being a, quote, utter repudiation of bankers and economists, an example of how extremism has gone mainstream, and how they must, quote, combine forces to stop us and stop today's citizen revolt in the United States, Britain, Europe, where we may upend politics and nothing else has in his lifetime. And they go on to talk about how to control us with our incomes and with our growth rate. As if, oh, if you don't let us run things, things are going to get bad, when their own stated goals are a post-industrial world where we work for less, have less, pay higher taxes to live in a 220-foot square foot coffin apartment that costs more than 1,000 square foot. I mean, they know what they're doing. They admit their program. And they just think you're too stupid to go figure it out. Well, even folks that don't want to be informed, as they start to lose everything, they're going to go and find out who's done it, and they're going to find out it's people like you. James Traub, that are guilty. What is the sentence? Guilty. 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 We sentence you to the Phantom Zone. I wish we could do that. It's like hell. Just go be with people like yourself. What is the sentence? guilty. And their arrogance convicts them. Public statements. German president. The elites are not the problem. This is a quote. The elites are not the problem. The populations are the problem. And then what do they recommend they use? Same thing they did to keep you out of the Brexit. The economy will implode. You'll all be homeless. You need us. We run everything. Submit to us or we'll bring you to your knees. They'll bring you to your knees if you let the boa constrictor that's wrapped around you maintain control. We figured out it was a boa constrictor. It's hissing in your ear saying, there's no global government. There's no tyranny. There's no problem. And you're like, okay, boy, it's hard to breathe. Well, just go to sleep, it tells you in your ear as it's wrapped around you. And the patriots are there going, no, it's a boa constrictor. The patriots are like a little angel on our collective shoulder. No, it's a boa constrictor. See it? Spots? See it? Are you having trouble breathing? That's a snake tongue coming out, licking your face. It's not kissing you. It's getting ready to crush you and eat you. And so, but the snake says if I resist, it'll eat me. It's already eating you, sweetheart. It's a snake. What did Donald Trump say? We've surrendered. Hillary's a foreign agent of the Chinese that run the trade war. Total veritas, total honor, total courage. I mean, I guarantee you, Hillary Clinton throws fits when a newspaper writes a bad article about her or she sees a YouTube video making fun of her. Can you imagine that veritable witch creature, the witch bitch? Can you imagine the convulsions she's having right now? And so she just peacocks that crazy Joker face like all the time. She looks completely nuts. I think Hillary, and I'm serious, I think she may go completely insane before the election. And I think we all, metaphysical's real, folks. We should all pray for justice against Hillary Clinton. We should all ask God to lead, guide, and direct us and just help us together focus our wills against Hillary Clinton. What we all need to do, my friends, that means politically, at every level, and spiritually, and culturally, and economically, this is a war. You don't lose engaging in this war. You spread your wings. You begin to truly live. And I know our audience already knows that, but I'm talking to new viewers. And we're starting to see a lot of controlled leftists, a lot of controlled right-wing folks. High-level editors of major newspapers, major publications are calling me up and apologizing. It's been happening the last decade, but it's epidemic now, saying, oh, my God, it's all real. It's really happening. I just met with a bunch of current generals, and they said, listen to Alex Jones. He knows what's going on. This is the truth. We can't tell you what's going on. It's all classified. Listen to him. And by the way, I want to say something. We've had everybody on from Cy Hirsch to Daniel Ellsberg of the Pentagon Papers to, you know, Colonel Schaefer to former KGB folks that are whistleblowers to, I mean, you name it. Charlton Heston, the whole nine yards. I mean, we've interviewed the people that write the biological weapons treaties, and we've had, you know, people on that were the roommates of Mitt Romney. I mean, we've just had everybody on. We've looked at every angle, basically. And we continue to look at the new angles that come up from different perspectives, but we've looked at a lot of angles, okay? I don't want to say every angle, but more angles than probably anybody else ever has. Because most people that are in the CIA or different analyst agencies, they kind of study one little discipline because they want to be the experts on that, okay? We are organic human intelligence against the New World Order, and so I study everything, wide spectrum. And the globalist are failing. The globalists are falling apart. The globalists are a joke. That's why they claim, oh, we're collapsing everything to build on its ashes. That's true in a way because they help grease the skids but insulate themselves, be the last man standing scenario. But the truth is they can't manage anything and they screw everything up and their spirit is destructiveness. So they just claim they are deploying destruction, command destruction to rebuild something on it to hide their spiritual ineptitude. Because the devil is never a maker. The less that they give, they're a taker. And it goes on and on, on and on and on. And they'll tell you that the moon is just the sun at night. And when you walk in golden halls, they'll tell you you can keep all the gold that falls. quoting some poetry. I forget who wrote it. CFR member calls on elites to rise up against ignorant masses. Wealthy heir to Bloomingdale's chain. I always love how it's some fourth generation fop whose eyes don't even point the right direction, just snurgling around, groveling, like, we've got to take their rights. We've got to show them who's boss. I'm so cuckold. Let's bring in a bunch of radical Muslims to come in and blow everything up and shoot everything up. Then we'll take the general public's freedoms away. And we've got to have a war against common knowledge and common sense. So let's not let anybody say all these attacks are Islamic. I mean, no one's saying they're Islamic now. Look at this mirror story. They usually at least admit it's Islamic. Chilling pictures of smiling Istanbul airport suicide bombers seconds from death mission as police fear another attack imminent. Never is it Islamic. Never. I mean, you know, a group of Boy Scouts went and did it to be Boy Scouts, or a group of right-wingers, or a group of... But no, this is just this talking point. You will not say it's Islamic. That is so authoritarian that the media is so controlled that you know, they tell us, don't use this word. This is now the proper word to use. People go, okay, I will now dutifully use whatever words you tell me in terms. What type of cult did the West become? Since when did I wake up in a lunatic asylum? Since when did I wake up at some, you know, Eastern ashram, you know, in the 60s going, you know, chanting until my brain is gone, you know, before some weirdo with an 8-foot beard? But instead, it's Obama and Hillary hopping around. It's a total joke. But as I said earlier, let me just go through a bunch of news right now. First off, briefly here, the special is unprecedented. We normally only run this once a year. We did this a few months ago. Because of all the mainstream news articles about FEMA saying, we believe, actually say, we believe, I'm going to play this clip next hour, we believe that it's probable that we will have the scenario of 395% food prices. Because I actually went and watched the actual video briefing that FEMA did on it, and my original interpretation was correct, that they're saying they believe this is happening. Because I know that was in British reports and Pentagon reports that we also cite in the upcoming report. But to actually see them saying it, they're kind of smiling while they talk about it, it's uber creepy. So all I'm saying is you need to get water filtration, you need to get storable foods, you need to get prepared. If you can, with family, get together, and I don't care if it's even 5-10 acres out in the middle of nowhere that's got well water or whatever, just so you can get away from major cities during a collapse or have a place to grow a garden, whatever. Everybody in Europe has that, even poor people do. That's just part of being human. People need to get back to the land. We sell high-quality non-GMO seeds. Everything for the 4th of July mega specials are now live. We're going to do this on Friday through Monday, but I'm going to just start today. 20% off Survival Shield X2. 20-40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food, 20% off Alexa Pure Water Filters, 20% off Alexa Pure Air Filters. These specials will run for a limited time while supplies last. This Independence Day is a great time to support the real tip of the spear when it comes to the fight for liberty. Your support makes everything we do possible, from exposing Hillary Clinton to fighting for the Constitution. Visit InfoWarsStore.com right now and secure your independence with these mega specials while supplies last. One more thing. Our air conditioner, speaking of society breaking down, isn't working too well. It's kind of hot in here. I always meant to do this. Will somebody just go get me some basic, cheap cotton handkerchiefs? Because I expect this will be broken for a while. And I'll take them home. I'll wash them tonight. But I want to get a stack of those because I don't like wiping my face with napkins. It gets chemicals into my face and stuff. I just don't like it. Little pieces of lint, whatever. Thank you. Just my assistant or whoever, thank you. I just said it on air because I'm going to forget to say it during the break, and then I have to get it out there now. Anyways, the point is this funds the operation. It's a great deal. It's super high-quality storable foods, the highest quality. It's very hard to get specials like this and to line it up with all these different companies to allow us, because we already have contracts that say this is the lowest advertised price we can do, and then we have to reach out to our suppliers and get agreements for how long we can do it. That's how this stuff works when we're already selling stuff at Amazon level. When we go below that, a whole bunch of different things trigger. And so it's very hard to do specials like this. And quite frankly, my accountant argues with me and shows me numbers and stuff and says you shouldn't always discount this much. That's why you sell so much stuff, but then the profit isn't big enough for the expansion plans you have. Whatever. You want to support us, get the Hillary for Prison t-shirt that's back in stock, a new design, but I think even better than the last one, at full price, $19.95. But at the same time, you need to take advantage of 20 to 40% off on InfoWars Select storable food. That is the best deal right now. And even if you've already gotten this high-quality food before, I would suggest getting more so that you have it for friends and family, and then you can give it to them at Christmas or for their birthday or whatever. And they've got week packs, month packs, three-month packs, six-month packs, year packs, all these different special diets, a huge selection, whatever you want. It's powered by My Patriot Supply at InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. Okay, I'm going to stop at that point. Please support our local affiliates and become sponsors or support their sponsors as well. But just one last piece on that front. Secret government warehouse stockpiling for pandemic can't be discussed publicly. It is clear they are gearing up for something. Yeah, I mean, I've got to say the preparation for martial law and civil unrest and economic disaster and bio disaster and earthquakes, volcanoes, it's 10 times anything I've ever seen. And I'm just hoping it's just a looting by special interest through the COG. Continuity of government systems. I mean, that's bad enough, but at least some money from taxpayers will actually go into an economy, even if it's government employees and contractors, because most of the trillions just get locked up in big mega banks' vaults that they just use to leverage everybody else out to put us in debt. They create tens of trillions in bailout to themselves, freeze the money just to say we're in debt to them and get interest. I mean, you talk about raping somebody with sandpaper. I mean, this is brutal. Brutal, 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 brutal. But, I mean, what more do you expect? They're assaulting us. They're announcing they're in a war against us. They're so arrogant. And then when we dare stand up to them, they panic and go, fine, we're your enemies. We're your elite. Our eyes don't point the right directions. We were given our wealth five generations ago by people that robbed others. Oh, my God, we're foppish. Worship us. And just, no, I do not worship you. A bunch of sycophantic morons who are OCD, mentally ill. I don't want to insult the average OCD person, but you get around inbred elites. I don't care if it's rich African royalty or European royalty or Arab royalty. They're a bunch of inbred, crazy people that are spoiled brat potentates that think they're God, and we're facing the same fight we fought in 1776. A bunch of trash saying they're God, and it's their right to rule over us because they're hunchbacked and their eyes don't point the right direction, but they own the power structure through fraud and now want to have a class warfare with a bunch of stupid, dumbed-down people to wage war against what's left of the middle class so they can blow up the stairway that's left to poor people, to upper mobility. They want to sew this thing up, and I'm not going to sit here and watch this screw job. Where do you start? It really is amazing that they're now in full panic mode, and now things that we were talking about 20 years ago. 20 years ago, I was interviewing Ron Paul, 21 years ago. It was about 20 years ago when he was running for Congress again in 1996. And again, Austin was part of his district then, so he really wanted on my show a lot. He would come on like every week. And he wouldn't go super far on New World Order or world government. He would talk a little bit about it, and listeners were like, wow, he admitted New World Order, global government when you asked. And I mean, no one would talk about that. I mean, the ADL would say that you were a racist. It didn't exist. I remember hearing national talk show hosts say the CFR did not exist when I was in high school in 1992, about to graduate. I remember Rush Limbaugh, and I'm not bashing him, because they'd fire him at the time if he did it, Roger Ailes. And by the way, the word is Roger Ailes doesn't like the New World Order either. He's on a leash. It was so unsafe then. And by the way, this isn't about InfoWars getting credit. It's about you getting credit, and it's about realizing we're winning. We're on the march. The global empire of the new royalty of the Kim Jong-uns and the CFRs and the Hillary Clintons, they're losing. That isn't hype. When I've been telling you the last 5 years, when I'm sort of getting more optimistic, that we're on the march, the empire's on the run, and that I talked to so many people in media and government and worldwide. They are so awake but scared to speak out. And people like myself and those of you out there and the Drudge Report and WorldNet Daily and others have really forced reality into the debate. And that is the most valuable thing in the universe to me. A brand new million-dollar Bentley would mean nothing to me. They're very nice, I'm sure, very cool cars. I'd sell it and, you know, buy a Ford Raptor and then give the rest to charity or something. The point is, I'm not saying it's bad to own something nice if that's what you like. I don't value things. I value a flower garden in my backyard more than I value a big diamond ring on my wife's finger, hypothetically. And that just shows the type of folks we are in the Liberty Movement, the type of folks you are versus them. Most people would sell their mommy out for a 10-carat diamond ring. Most people want to pull up in the most expensive Bentley at the country club because they want people to know they're successful. Now, the super rich are going to pull up in the Ford F-150 and have a T-shirt with holes in it because they actually are more sophisticated than that. But there's this whole sycophantic underclass of wealthy that will do anything to feel like they're accepted by the upper elite. And the so-called wannabe elite never understand why they're not let into the elite. And that's because you aren't into slitting small children's throats. So don't feel bad you haven't been let in. You don't like raping children. So you're not going to be let in. Okay, so you just drive your Bentleys and play golf and fly around in helicopters and act rich and want to be at the Formula One out front with everybody looking at you. Just be narcissistic idiots while your vampire bosses are slitting little kids' throats and hanging them up by their feet. Where to start, my friends? We have the valiant Secret Service agent, Gary Byrne, joining us coming up in the next segment. Crisis of Characters, the book. Hey, can we get the clip queued up where he talked about her being a dictator, Hillary? What did CNBC, talking to one of the top internet gurus, say about Zuckerberg? They said he's dictator of the biggest nation on earth, over 2 billion people, Facebook. That's exactly what these people are. Technocratic systems just means a dictatorship of a technological elite. And then I have this tendency to not even mention our most powerful articles up front. Everyone should be constantly at InfoWars.com, PrisonPlanet.com, because there's just such bombshell stuff up there. I mean, this is mainstream news in Philadelphia with a straight face. School calls police on 9-year-old for racist remark called snack brownies. This is not The Onion. This is real. Remember when Seattle said, don't bring brown paper bags? And they admitted, no one ever said they were racist. No one ever said a brown bag was meant anything. I'm wearing brown shoes right now, folks. I got brown skin. Light brown. I'm evil. One of my daughters has got brown eyes. The others have got green. I love those little Cookie Monster eyes. And, of course, it's illogical. It's just about illogic. It's about being illogical. And this is in Philadelphia. Philly.com reports it with a straight face. I mean, the kids are just being turned into basket cases. The white kids. But then if a minority wants to knock a white kid out and almost kill him with brass knuckles, that's okay because they're white and they deserve it. That's in the news. You want to kill somebody because they're white, that's all right. Cracker had it coming. And again, most people who are minorities aren't like this. It's the media pushing this, telling them it's okay to act like this. That's why the Klan was so bad in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, because a lot of media in the South was promoting it like it was a good thing. And now the media promotes, go out and attack Trump people, go beat up women. And the LA Times is like, hey, they deserve it. A bunch of men waving Mexican flags, beating a woman up, and it's not racial because she's white. No, the truth is every group can act like a bunch of tribal morons. And while you're busy doing that, all of our freedoms are being taken and we're being chemically attacked with the fluoride and all the rest of it. During an end of year class party at a New Jersey elementary school, a 9-year-old boy, this was out of Philly.com, was in New Jersey, said something about brownies and was subsequently questioned by a police officer who was called by the school to investigate an incident of racism. Oh, yeah. It was another student that accused the boy of saying something racist. Because, see, you don't learn how to read or write now. You just learn how to hear things that upset you. But the boy's mother said he was talking about snacks, not skin color. And there's a new thing where they're telling bartenders. I heard about this a few years ago, and then I've talked to bartenders. They tell especially Hispanic bartenders or people that are serving drinks that are from Mexico or here legally or whatever, you know, at the restaurant, but don't come up and ask if you want a lager or a like if you ask for a Modelo. They're actually telling bartenders, because they'll say, like when you're in Mexico, they'll say blonde or negro. And they're telling them, don't say that, because not just black people who are ignorant, but white people especially will flip out on you when you say the Spanish word for black. Just means negro. Just means, I mean, words are now evil, folks, that have nothing to do with anything. This is the mass mental illness we're dealing with. While all of us are having our rights taken and freedoms taken, we are obsessing over stuff like this. It is crazy. Coming up, we've seen the president of Mexico, the leader of Canada, and, of course, the president of the U.S. meeting, pushing the expansion of NAFTA and GATT, trying to hurry that through before Donald Trump gets into office. We've got the EU coming out, the Council on Foreign Relations, saying that they want to have economic warfare to force us to stay inside these global agreements that we never voted to enter. It's amazing. And in the middle of all this, we've got Hillary Rodham Clinton, who I've been covering for 21 years on air. I remember her and the Chinese missile secrets and selling us out to foreign powers. I remember all the deaths. I remember FBI agents that were in the White House coming out and talking about the bizarre stuff they saw that later Hillary admitted. She goes, oh, it's a joke that I've got crack pipes and Mao Zedong on the Christmas tree. Remember that? It's like, what's wrong with you? These are, from the outside looking in, seem like degenerates, seem like mentally ill people that are just into doing weird stuff. Perverts, basically. I mean, I don't have a degree in criminology, you know, like our next guest does, but sitting back watching this and studying Kim Jong-un and his megalomania, I look at Hillary, it seems like she's a would-be dictator, and we're going to go to our guest, who's the valiant Secret Service agent that's had the will to go public, Dan Bongino, another guy that has a lot of courage, is going to be joining us tomorrow. Crisis of Character, Gary J. Byrne, a White House Secret Service officer, discloses his firsthand experience with Hillary, Bill, and how they operate. And I have just started reading the book, and it is just nightmarish because it fits into everything we've already seen and know. I mean, this woman has a criminal mind. He has criminal energy. Now, that's a layperson's view. We're going to get his view here in just a moment. But first, here's a clip of where he called it like it is and said she's a dictator. Here it is.
And in 2016, she's running again. And you felt compelled to tell the story because why? Let me ask that.
Because I want Americans to know what the real Clinton administration is like. Mrs. Clinton is not a leader. She's a very, very angry person all the time. I've seen many instances that I talk about in my book, Crisis of Character, where she displays this holier-than-thou attitude, do as I say, not as I do. She's a dictator. She comes across as a dictator. I've seen her berate many people, and myself included. And I've never seen any example that would lead me to believe that she could lead this country.
I mean, you know, you describe a woman that is very phony. In other words, you talk about how she'd tell you to go to hell or tell another agent to go blank himself.
Correct.
And how she threw a Bible at a Secret Service officer or agent.
Agent. Yes, sir.
Okay, and the vase story, which we'll get to in a minute.
Right.
But if the cameras were on, she was close to Bill, but it was manufactured. It was not real.
Absolutely.
Camera goes off, different person.
Yeah.
All right, let's go to him now, but I wanted to show that clip from Hannity. Now. I've had Bongino on. I've talked to other Secret Service folks off record. They didn't give me anything secret. They just said, look, it's worse than you know. It's worse than you're saying. And I was once at a party with a celebrity, and there was a current Secret Service guy there, pretty senior, and he said, no, Alex, you're dead on, but it's worse than you're saying. And then I talked to Bongino, said the same thing. And he never told me anything secret. They started threatening him when he came on. What'd you tell Alex? Because I was saying some stuff on air about what we know about the Clintons, and they thought he told me. His house got broken into. His car did. His kids basically got threatened. He doesn't want me to talk about it because it sounds wimpy to, you know, talk about threats, but it's not. These guys have real courage. I got to tell you, Mr. Byrne, I mean, I hope he doesn't have any car accidents or airplane accidents or anything, because the Clintons are organized criminals, in my view, and there's a lot of death around them. But I'm going to stop right there. Mr. Byrne, thank you so much for coming on. CrisisOfCharacterBook.com. Let's go to the waterfront here. Tell us. I mean, you're putting your life on the line here. I think that goes unsaid. So this isn't about just selling a book. Tell us the truth, sir. You're warning America.
Sure. I wrote my book. First of all, thank you for having me. I wrote my book because I want people to know the truth, just like you said. And all those things that you were saying about senior people in the Secret Service telling you that everything you've said before is true. And that's one of the reasons I wrote my book. I want people to know what the real Hillary Clinton's like. Listen, if she wasn't running for office, I wouldn't care. I wouldn't care at all. But she has a good chance of becoming the next president of the United States. And I want people to know that that is not a good thing. She has an explosive, dangerous personality. She has this inability to focus on the problem. She seems to focus on what caused the problem. I've seen her berate her staff that were supposedly friends of hers to the point where they were terrified of her. And it just goes from one thing to the other.
There's been reports of her by other Secret Service agents punching Bill Clinton repeatedly. I mean, almost knocking him down. Are those reports accurate?
So I've never witnessed that, but I did see the president show up at the Oval Office one morning after a bad fight up at the mansion the night before, where a vase got broken. And when he showed up at the Oval Office house, he had a black eye, he had a mark under his eye, and he was trying to conceal it with makeup. And to the point where I actually said to his secretary and his assistant, what's that mark under the president's eye? And they said, he's allergic to coffee. I said, allergic to coffee under one eye? And as I walked out of the room, I actually turned to the other assistant, the secretary, and I said, I'm allergic to the back of somebody's hand. And I was just trying to get a rise out of him to see what the deal was. And it was just so bizarre. I mean, I realized people fight at times. But once you hear these, you witness these things, and my coworkers, we don't talk about these things because we have nothing else to do. We pass this information on, so the next person.
No, I understand. It's unprecedented to have the Secret Service, and you're not the only one coming out. But I mean, it obviously has to be done. I mean, the word I get from high level Pentagon, high level State Department, high level former CIA, and is that Hillary basically is a Chinese agent / Saudi Arabian agent, and I want to. See if we can segue into some of that, because you've mainly, just covered her outburst. But correct me if I'm wrong. Right. You were there at the White House for quite a while. You might get into that history. But it looks like following her for 20 years, being forced to, it's not like I want to watch her or read her or see what she does. Seems like her lies are getting wilder. She seems more unstable, looks even crazier than she did 20 years ago. She seems to be deteriorating is what I'm getting at.
Yeah. So I've never seen anything that would lead me to believe that she's, I mean, other than, like, her policies seem to lean to some of these countries, but I've never seen anything that I would call, out of the ordinary. But what I, along the lines you were talking about as she's getting older is, my take on it, Alex, is that she's getting more and more comfortable with it, that she's being more and more the real Hillary, which I, in my opinion, she's more of a dictator than anything else. I think she's getting comfortable with it. I think she feels like it's been accepted by the people who are going to vote her in. And that's the way it's going to be.
Well, expanding on that, I don't normally go off a book by their cover, but clearly sometimes you're pumping gas and some thugs pull up. It doesn't matter whether black thugs, white thugs, whoever, you just pick up these guys are thugs. And sure enough, you see one of them, shoot their mouth off at, an old lady or something. And when you look at her, though, she just radiates like she could play a female Joker. I mean, if I was in casting in Hollywood, and I actually have been worked in some films and consulting, I would cast her as a female supervillain. I mean, I'm not being sarcastic.
Yeah.
As a guy that has a gut instinct, criminology background, just her demeanor, the way she looks and acts sometimes, and the way her face has changed so suddenly, what's going on there? Because to me, she looks like she's mentally ill.
Well, I'll give you two examples of kind of the outburst that you're talking about. When I was still working at the White House, we had hired some new employees. And these two young officers, I was down in the break room, and a young officer came down. And he said, man, what a weird day. And we said, what's going on? He said, well, he passed by the first lady, and he said hello. And she told him to go to hell. And, we said, well, that's that's the way it is around here. You know, she doesn't seem to like us much. And then another guy came in, he walked up and he said, that's nothing. He said, last month I was walking past her down the West Colonnade, and he said good morning to her, and she told him to go F himself. And so that's two examples. And this happened the way it happened, Alex. A sergeant overheard them telling the stories to the other, myself and the other people down there, and they investigated it. And the senior agents of the agency took this so serious, they came down to talk to this guy, two inspectors, and they actually apologized and said, just understand this, that, you know, you're not going to get an apology from anyone else. And the bizarre thing about that, Alex, was the second guy who she told to go F himself, he had been in the Army a couple of years before, and he had been in Somalia on a mission, basically, that President Clinton had sent him on. And it wasn't, you know, today we know that the Somalia, because of the movie Black Hawk Down.
They hung him out to dry.
Right. This was before that, like the first deployment to Somalia. And this guy was wounded and received the Purple Heart. Then a couple of years later, he comes to work for the Secret Service Uniform Division, and the first lady tells him to go F himself. It's just so bizarre. This is one of the reasons I felt compelled. This is the person that people want to put in the Oval Office.
Yeah.
I think it's insane.
Well, bottom line, Gary, I've just noticed, you know, being around a few years, that criminal types don't like police officers, folks like that. And it's not that police are perfect or Secret Service are perfect. They just don't like the manliness. They don't like the straightforwardness. They don't like being looked in the eye. And I've confirmed with dozens of reporters over the 20 years and people that have worked around her, meetings she goes to, like Davos and others, that they tell people, and I've interviewed the people at the hotels after these events are over. I mean, I've made films on this, that they tell people in briefings, do not look Hillary in the eye. So as bad as you've been getting it, and other law enforcement officers, the word is when she is out around just general folks, no tips. And it's not just her. It's this whole group. You know, no tips, very rude, very hateful. I mean, separately, I don't want to segue off of Hillary, but I mean, I'm told that it's not as bad, but it's similar with Obama. And it's similar with his wife?
Yeah, that I don't know about, because I left before they got there. I actually left when George W. Bush was president in 2003. I transferred to the Air Marshal. So that I don't have any information on. I'm sorry.
It's been in the press, though.
Yes. I've seen it. Yeah, I've seen it. And I've read some of the same stories you have. Absolutely.
Well, I'll tell you this. When they bring up our show or InfoWars to her, we played the video, she all of a sudden goes and her eyes get wide and she has like an adrenaline rush and just gets scared. And it sounds to me like that's the type of response she has around guys like you.
Yes. Yes. I think that's I agree with you. It's so bizarre to think about the things that I've written when I was writing my book, Crisis of Character, and you look at the stuff in there. And, you know, writing a book, you review it and you edit it and you edit it. And some of this stuff, I was like, oh, my God, it's just so crazy. She could be the next president of the United States, and she's under FBI investigation. How does that keep going on? How is that possible?
And she's been caught lying from every angle. It's ridiculous.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, you know, according to the history of the Watergate investigation, she was fired from that. Because of unseemly behavior. I mean, that just sounds so bizarre.
Well, you know, FBI agents that works in the White House and others have been audited, harassed, all sorts of things have happened. I don't want to, you know, get into speculation areas here,
but
making the decision with you and your family to write this book, I mean, really nobody else has had the huevos to do this, maybe one other person. I mean, I got to say, sir, I really hope you've got a big insurance policy taken out for your family.
Yeah, so we... We knew what we were getting into, and we've taken our precautions and did our due diligence. So,
yeah,
we'll keep our fingers crossed.
Well, you know what? You're on the side of right, and just we really. I mean, I'm serious. I'm not kissing your butt. I don't do this with a lot of my guests.
I understand, I appreciate that.
Well, I admire your courage. I mean, if we had more people like you, sir, we wouldn't be in such trouble.
Well, thank you so much. I greatly appreciate it.
What can you talk about the process of deciding to write this book, Crisis of Character, sir?
Sure. You know, 10 years ago, if somebody suggested I was going to do this, I would have said they were crazy. I thought I would take this stuff to my grave. But things changed over the years, Alex. And as it got closer and closer to this election and I saw she was more likely to win, I thought, how can this happen? How can somebody that operates like this have an opportunity to become president of this country. And so I decided that I would write a book about my life. And I would, of course, include all of it and my time there. And, you know, the original title of my book was actually Fence Jumpers to Hijackers, you know, my time at the White House and then my time as an air marshal. But as it got more to time to put the book out, and as we developed it, it became Crisis of Character. And it's not just about her crisis of character. It's a little bit about my crisis of character, too, to, you know, the process of deciding to do this and putting yourself and your family at this kind of risk.
Yeah, I can hear it in your voice. You have really put yourself at risk, folks. I hope listeners understand this is not a game. I have been seriously threatened by the Clintons years ago and went and had some really nasty experiences that are almost unbelievable. I haven't even gotten into them on air. And so I can imagine what, I mean, you know, have you ever met Dan Bongino? Do you know him?
You know what? We crossed paths in training when I was still an instructor. I don't know him well.
You know, they've been like threatening his kids, breaking in his house, everything.
Yeah. I follow him now on social media. So,
yeah,
that's, I know, I believe it. He's an upstanding guy.
But he didn't even really write a book about them. He just wrote a book about taking America back, and they're coming after him. So, boy, they're really going to, whoo.
Right.
I mean, I tell you.
Bizarre.
Well, we got about 5 minutes left, sir. I really appreciate your courage. Everyone should get the book. In fact, I'm going to reach out to your publisher, Center Street, who has a lot of courage, and I'm going to try to carry it in our online bookstore at InfoWarsStore.com. But the book is on sale. It needs to go to number one, folks, and really be a vote for courage and a vote against this criminal. We sell the T-shirt. It's back in stock. Hillary for prison. That's available at InfoWarsStore.com. And of course, these are all over TV. They're all over the Trump rallies. It was the number one meme last week and the number one search term for a full week. It's the number three search term this week. Will Hillary Clinton go to prison? And I'm very proud of the fact that we have basically started this meme and that you, the listeners, have taken it to the next level. So I want to say that I am right behind this man. I don't have any of the courage he's got to be doing this, but we're in the same arena here, and I hope you'll join him in the arena and get the book, Crisis of Character. We got 4 minutes left, sir. I want you to have the floor. A lot of stuff's in the book, but you know, spill your guts to folks. You're putting your life on the line. Tell people what you really think about Hillary.
Sure. Thank you. So my time at the White House, I experienced many bizarre things. And, you know, you can understand her anger sometimes when she finds out what her husband's doing with these affairs. But my question is, why do you stay in that relationship and keep exposing yourself to all this mental damage? And my fear is that at this point in her life, where she's about to become president of the United States, I mean, how damaged is she? I mean, how emotional can she really get? And that's what concerns me. And the things that I saw when I worked there, many examples of her anger and really, to me, her inability to function normally. I mean, how is it you can treat your staff so poorly that they're afraid of you? And so that's what really one of the things that amongst others that greatly concerned me. Is there any particular part of the book you'd like me to talk about?
Well, I mean, I've only gotten, you know, a little bit into it. It's amazing. I just, you know, to me, it just shows how unstable she is. And I know you're being a nice guy and you're going with what you can totally prove. But the word is she just gets mad. She just gets mad when she doesn't get a piece of the tail. The word is, yeah, you know, Clinton used to joke, and so did Roger, his brother, that she's sees more tail than Bill does. And we're not attacking her in the fact that she's bisexual, but it's pretty evident that she is. I'm worried about that from the blackmail perspective. The word is she'd beat Bill up when he didn't follow orders. I mean, from the inside sources we have, and they've kind of bragged about this, it wasn't just co-presidency. A lot of the time, Hillary was more of a president than Bill because he was so busy partying. And so can you speak to that? I mean, their real relationship.
Right.
You know, the fact that she could be blackmailed.
Sure. I definitely saw a different, like, you know, when the cameras weren't on, she's always aloof. Even when the cameras are on, like, to me, she's never genuine. I think many times in the last year, you've heard messages from her campaign where they're rebooting to make Mrs. Clinton more likable, more
so. Who is the real one? Past the aloof, past the little fake robot lady with the Joker smile. Who is she? You were around her for years.
She's somebody who's very angry for some reason I don't really understand, besides the actions of her husband. She's somebody who is, to me, is incompetent. I mean, look what happened. You know, she was Secretary of State for 4 years, and we got Benghazi. And as soon as it happened, she got out. She left. A real leader, Alex, would have stayed there and fixed the problems. So never again is one of our ambassadors murdered like that.
So you're just too honorable of a guy, brother, to see that Benghazi was on purpose to ship the missiles to Al Qaeda to take over Syria. And the Turkish ambassador was there that morning, and Ambassador Stevens said no. So they pulled the security and had him whacked. But I mean, I'm not going to like get off on a rabbit trail. It's just that she's way more evil than I think you're even getting at.
No, well, obviously she is, and that's not something I experienced, but I certainly believe that to be true. I mean, nothing would surprise me anymore after what I saw those years and what's happened since then. There are many examples I put in my book. You know, also details that, but I never thought that we'd be in the position where that she was getting ready to become president of the United States. Alex, years ago when they first started running from Arkansas, I ran into this deputy down there, and we were talking. We were working together for about 4 hours outside this restaurant protecting President Clinton. And this, or I'm sorry, not President Clinton, President Bush. Bill Clinton was just starting to run.
Sure.
First President Bush. And we were talking, and I said, what about this guy, this governor of yours that wants to run? And he goes, and I said, you know, all these affairs and these rumors, he'll never get elected. And the guy looked at me, I mean, right through me, and he said, let me tell you something, Gary. These guys can spin manure into gold. Then everything you hear about them is true. Believe it. And he will get elected, and he'll be there 8 years. And this guy was serious as a heart attack. And then he told me all these bizarre stories about all these rumors of people that, you know, have had accidents and stuff that you were referring to before. So, I definitely think that if she gets elected, that we're going to see the crazy stuff we've seen for the last 8 years is going to look like a walk in the park.
Well, let me give you the intel directly from the Pentagon, you name it, across the board. And, of course, you were there when they were bringing the Chinese generals in and all that. She basically is a Chinese agent, a communist agent, but for money, and other elites are, so she's too big to fail. She's so corrupt and so bad and has done stuff so horrible, it'll bring down the whole government. So she thinks she's invincible.
Yeah. Well, my fear is, what if she is? That's my fear. I mean, what if she does get in?
We only got 30 seconds. I want to have you back. CrisisOfCharacterTheBook.com. But, sir, yeah, what do you think will happen if she gets in 30 seconds?
In 30 seconds, I think that after all the parties are over, I think the markets are going to swing. That's my fear. I also think that she's going to move towards more of a dictatorship, more socialism. We're going to see more of these.
Wow, so you think Hillary will move towards a dictatorship?
Yeah, I do. I think she'll move more towards socialism.
Incredible, sir. Thank you so much for your courage. And you notice the New World Order's bleeding to death right now. And I'm afraid it's going to continue. Because every tyrant, every group of oligarchs always thinks they're invincible throughout history. Hitler didn't know he was going to lose until the Russians encircled Berlin. And he finally figured out he was done. And it's the same psychology over and over again. Hillary Clinton will fall. You can bet your bottom dollar on that one. And everything she symbolizes will fall. For me, it's not personal, the Clinton stuff. Because I was told, leave the Clintons alone. I was fired from my job. Number one at night on local radio. And then I was physically attacked. And then I was threatened in parking lots. And they kept saying, why don't you shut your mouth? We're gonna kill you. And so I just let them know when they'd call me, well, I'm carrying a gun now. So you better get me first. They stopped coming around. And again, I beat the living hell out of the people they sent. I broke their ribs. I broke their noses. They had a lot of trouble getting in their blue Astro van, I can tell you that. And that's what I'm going to do politically to the globalists. And that's what you're going to do. They want to fight? They got one. Remember that guy broke my nose with a sucker punch, and he thought I was going to go down. And instead, I just crawled right on top of him, and I crawled on all those other guys, too. And they were freaking out, and my blood was spraying out of my nose on them. And I was tearing them up. Don't talk about the Clintons. Ideas are bulletproof. Figure that out yet? I don't think I'm invincible. But the truth and justice, long term, is invincible. In fact, we have a V for Vendetta intro. Roger Stone's coming on. He's late getting to his Skype because he did this last minute. And that's just such a powerful part when they've shot V about 100 times and he doesn't matter. He's already won the mission. He gets the gun. He goes, you may have taken me out, but I'm taking you out, and ideas are bulletproof. And that's really living right there, is not being a coward, folks, and not letting these parasites feed on people anymore. They're going to go down. They will fall in the final equation. Briefly, other news we haven't even gotten to. I mentioned this, but just look at this. School calls police on 9-year-old for racist remark calling brownies brownies. Tommy Robinson accused by police of inciting racial hatred over a F ISIS flag in England. That's one of the nationalist groups. I mean, they're talking about arresting him. He's been on the show before for having an F ISIS flag with the St. George flag. Oh, by the way, they say the St. George flag, I guess that's the red cross on the white original English flag, that they're saying don't fly that. The police show up if you fly that now because it's a symbol of England. That's racist. I mean, what? I mean, this is really going on. But look at this. Breaking: Paris terror attack weapon linked to Fast and Furious. Who broke here years ago that guns were going from Fast and Furious, not just into Mexico, but to Al-Qaeda and ISIS? We had the whistleblowers on. It's now Judicial Watch has it. Leon McAdoo reported on it. It's also on Infowars.com, an article that Clifford Cunningham wrote about. Such a big deal. Now, before I go any further, secret government warehouse stockpiling for pandemic can't be discussed publicly. I'd say Infowars.com posted article, Max Slavo. Here's another report in from NPR. Inside a secret government warehouse prep for health catastrophes. The globalists want to make us dependent. Now's the time to get independent. And we are running a special right now through the 4th of July that is the biggest ever. 30 to 40% off on storable foods. We do that like once a year. I did it a few months ago. And because things are getting so serious, I've just had the idea this week. I said, we're just going to go all out with a special on all preparedness items. From 20 to 40% off on Survival Shield X2, 20 to 40% off on all Infowars Select storable food, 20% off on Alexa Pure water filters, 20% off Alexa Pure air filters. These specials will run right through the 4th of July. I'll probably keep them until Tuesday. You're crazy, in my humble opinion, if you're not self-sufficient. Every government agency, every major corporation stockpiles food, stockpiles weapons, stockpiles communications, and has getaway plans for their executives, helicopters and jets on standby. And they didn't used to do this. They're all gearing up. And it's because things are, we're sitting on a whole bunch of bubbles. The globalists are starting wars. They're bringing in giant millions of military-age men into Europe that are jihad forces. If they bring down Europe, and let me tell you something, folks, you start having 100 attacks a week, it'll cause a Great Depression. It could be 1,000 a week with the numbers we're talking about. This is a planned invasion of Europe, a total invasion, a land invasion directed by the globalist, working with Saudi Arabia and Islam. I mean, this is a total double cross. Who would think they'd use a Islamic army? 80% of them are military-age men. And I used to hear this, you know, I criticized Glenn Beck and people. He was hearing from other people, but he would say this like 8 years ago. And I'd say, that's ridiculous. Okay, they're doing a clash of civilizations. I know they're funding radical Islam. I know Saudi Arabia is doing bad stuff. I know they use terror attacks to take our rights, but they're not going to, you know, invade us with Muslims. I was wrong. I've looked at the force structure, the numbers, and it is 5 million, quote, refugees that were invaders into Syria, almost all of them. 80% military-age men. Man, like 15% of them are combatants. I mean, that's just a conservative number. I mean, we're talking about hundreds of thousands. I mean, if you have any idea what 100-something thousand people running around And by the way, they've all got full auto guns that they're getting that were military grade being shipped into Mexico to them from the United States. They're also getting weapons from Saudi Arabia. They have weapons. But I'm digressing. Take advantage of these specials. Get prepared, because it's not enough to have firearms. It's not enough to have a defense plan for you and your family. You need to be able to deal with months of not having food or electricity or water. You need to have a backup plan. Patriots must be self-sufficient to a certain extent. And believe me, I've never put in extra generators at the office. And, I mean, I've actually got more solar panels in at my house. I'm actually going over plans, going over road routes to if things totally collapse. I mean, look, the New World Order, they can set nukes off, folks. I'm telling you, in my gut, I can also intellectually see it. This election, all the destabilization garbage, the race war stuff for Soros' funding. This guy overthrows countries all the time. He's not playing games. He's talking about a Euro superstate with armies taking over countries that try to leave. I mean, that's in mainstream news. They are hardcore. So I don't know exactly what they're going to pull, because they don't know exactly. They're kind of, they got a bunch of irons in the fire here. But am I trying to scare you? Absolutely, because I'm concerned. I'm scared you're not going to be prepared. And I'll be quite honest. This is a pure symbiotic 360 win. I need more money to fund our operation, especially if a total depression is going to hit. I don't want to have to downsize and lay a bunch of people off and, who knows, go off the air. Everybody else is either downsizing right now or going bankrupt in media because it's such a huge bloom of so much media. I want to be one of the people standing at the end, and we're in a position to do that. We're at every metric, we're exploding in viewers and readers and listeners, and we are doing okay in revenue. But used to when audience exploded, revenue followed it. Audience explodes, revenue explodes. I expand. Not now. Audience is just blasting, like supernova, just super dangerous. The globalists are flipping out. I don't even like this. Okay, I hoped other people would be as big as I was, because I'm not a coward, but I'm also not stupid. I don't want the limelight. I don't want to have to do this. I act like a crazy man half the time because I'm so real. I just don't care. I want to act like an idiot, I act like one. I want to make jokes, I do it. I just, you know, I'm for real. Everybody knows that. The globalists hate me because they know I'm for real. And they know I'm committed. And they know you're committed. They hate you as well. But I, you know, it's, yeah, you need this. You need these filters. These are the best filters. These are the best shortwave radios. These are the best non-GMO heirloom seeds, wide spectrum, 14, 16 different brands now. I had them checked last week to make sure we have the lowest prices available. In many cases, we have the lowest prices. Whatever. We shouldn't even have to have the lowest prices. Everybody should go buy this stuff. In fact, I'm thinking about starting to offer some items that are at like retail, at where we actually get like 100%, you know, profit or something, you know, on it, so that I can really not have to worry about making money. Because listen, I would cut way back on sponsorship if you know, a certain point. I'm not just going to keep expanding forever, because it's dangerous to expand. You can get infiltrated. It's hard to manage things. I need like 4 or 5 more editors, 4 or 5 more camera people, 4 or 5 more writers, and some more customer service and IT people. I mean, I need like 10 more people. The problem is I hire those people, I then can't give raises to the other people unless we expand, which is still a good mission because we need to expand. I mean, it's just, it's all 360 win. Everything I do is about, it's got to be a 360 win. It's got to benefit everybody unless it's the globalists. They're the parasites overrunning us, giving us no quarter. They must be defeated. Do we have Roger Stone yet? All right, we're getting him lined up. He came on short notice. Sometimes he has some technical issues. Let's just go with phone if we can do that. Now, all I'm saying is 20 to 40% off InfoWarsLife.com, Survival Shield X2, 24% off InfoWars Select Storable Foods. And when we say select, that's the name I came up with. It's just a private label. It's the full spectrum of the high quality My Patriot supply. You can buy the full spectrum of My Patriot. It's drop ship from them at InfoWarsStore.com, right next to InfoWars Select, if you'd like. And by the way, this is fresh, new food. They made me stop the special a few months ago because they were about to sell out and couldn't even keep up with capacity. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And the Hillary for Prison shirts are now back in stock. The new design, it's the same overall design, but a red InfoWars.com on the right shoulder. Very handsome shirt. Now, joining us for a brief interview until the end of the hour is Roger Stone of StoneZone.com, former head of the campaign, the Trump campaign. His business partner, of course, is currently the head of the campaign. and Roger Stone, joining us via video Skype, has written a powerful article for Town Hall about would Ronald Reagan vote for Donald Trump, and another powerful article that we've been covering, the fact that he in many polls like Rasmussen is now ahead of Hillary. And I know I talked to Stone and others over the weekend, and he said, look, in most polls they're a dead heat or Trump's ahead, but that's internal polling. Hillary's putting out all these fake polls. So to talk polls and to talk Ronald Reagan, the Gipper, that's his article, what would he think of the great Trumpkin? Thank you for joining us, Mr. Stone.
Alex, great to be back with you. I'm calling from the New York bunker today, where I'm hunkered down in front of the computer writing.
Well, you've got the floor. Thank you for your time. Tell us first about these polls. And I know you like to be too optimistic, but this is pretty exciting. Let's get into your article in Town Hall.
Sure. I think it's very important to understand the dynamics of this election. In Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, you have very polarizing figures who have great intensity among their supporters and great animosity against their detractors, those who are opposed. And the country is fairly evenly divided between left and right. Therefore, this race, I think, is never going to be in a situation in which either candidate is out of range of winning. So it doesn't really matter whether Donald Trump is down 5 points next week, but leading by 5 points the week after that. I expect the race to seesaw. Polling is an art form. There are good pollsters and bad pollsters. By that I mean there are accurate pollsters and there are pollsters who make methodological errors in terms of...
Sure, to try to create the perspective that Hillary's really winning.
Well, some of them certainly are. The left-leaning polls, take PPP, for example, they'll never show the Republicans winning in any state or they'll never show numbers that are...
Yeah, Hillary's 800 points ahead, according to them, yeah.
Yeah, but look, in all honesty, we're citing the Rasmussen poll today. I've been very critical of Rasmussen, Alex, because 3-4 years ago, he continued to take surveys without including Gary Johnson and Judge Jim Gray, two good friends of mine, in his ballot. And that's unprofessional. They were on the ballot in 48 states.
Absolutely. What's the what can you tell us about internal polling? I know some of that's held close to the vest, but I've talked to some other folks. They say,
all I can say, and this is anecdotal, of course, and in no way formal, but it is my understanding that in certain swing states, acknowledging that that Trump had a rough couple weeks, but I think has certainly turned the corner on that and is now back on the upswing, helped, ironically, by additional issues pertaining to international Islamic terrorism. In the several key states that you and I would both refer to as swing states, particularly some of the medium-sized swing states, Trump continues to lead, and all the others, he continues to hold his own. If you're in this race, if you're up 3 points, well, that's probably within the margin of error. Now, there is a problem of chronically sampling Republicans that I have seen in many of these mainstream polls. That's one way to cook the poll. Sometimes they oversample key Democratic groups. That's also a way to cook these polls. But so I just think any consumer out there reading the media who reads about the polls should take them with a grain of salt. Trump's own polling and polling friendly to him shows that he is certainly in a position to win this race.
You never gave me any Trump secrets. I mean, obviously, that's why you're a confidant. But you did a few times say, this is what you're going to see in Wisconsin. This will be the real numbers. This is what you're going to see in this state. And you were just incredibly accurate every time. So I know you like to lowball things so that people don't get too optimistic. But I tell you, I mean, he keeps getting more and more of these Reagan Democrats and people that have never voted. And I see the internet searches. Google can track this. Are a lot of people that have never voted are now really getting involved and looking at Trump. And a lot of folks are also scared to say they're for Trump because of political correctness. But I think you're really going to go for Trump. I think you add that into the skew of the polls. And I think Trump really is. I think Trump's probably really about 5 points ahead. And I think if he keeps hammering and savaging Hillary, then he's going to end up maybe beating her in a landslide.
Well, that is, of course, the strategic imperative of his campaign. Look, Alex, if this election is about Donald Trump, then Trump will lose. But if this election is about Hillary Clinton, which it should be because it's a referendum on the past 8 years, and I think we all acknowledge her policies would essentially be a continuation.
That's right. Stay there. She's the establishment. It needs to be, hey, he's new, she's old. We need to get rid of her. She's guilty for where we are. Great point, Roger Stone. Stay with us. We'll be back with more of them. All right. Roger Stone is with us a little bit in the next hour. Then I am going to open the phones up to talk about whatever issue, long-time callers, first-time callers, new listeners, people that disagree, agree, whatever. We got a bunch of news. We're going to cover then as well. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. StoneZone.com is his website. He's got two books out on the Hillary Clinton's war on women and the Bush crime family, and how they all work together. Absolutely. Talk about a referendum on the corrupt, rotten Washington establishment and Trump coming out with that economic speech and saying Hillary is an agent of the Chinese. He said the Chinese are in a trade war with us and she's an agent against us in that war and the era of surrender is over. We're already in a trade war and we're losing badly. This is pure veritas. Speaking on how Trump's really getting aggressive and suddenly surges in polls. And then let's get into what would Ronald Reagan think of Trump? Because you knew both men very, very well and know Trump.
Well, Alex, first of all, I appreciate InfoWars publishing my piece, which makes the very case that Reagan and Trump were very similar in many ways, both unabashed believers in American power and American sovereignty, both nationalists, both outside the control of the Wall Street, K Street elite. Certainly, Reagan had his relationship with them, but he wasn't like Trump. He was an outsider. He came from a different discipline than politics, that being entertainment. But he also had the larger-than-life celebrity quality that Trump has. When you meet Trump, you know you've met a superstar. I mean, he has a presence that is filling arenas across the country in the last year. And like Reagan, I think Donald has ability to make himself understood. He talks in a way that people can relate to. Like Reagan, he talks in a way that working people particularly can relate to. Beyond that, he has a great sense of humor, as Reagan did. And he's a fighter. They were both fighters. When Reagan was on the verge of knockout in the 1976 campaign after taking beating after beating after beating by Gerald Ford, he stayed in the race when all of his top advisors, and I was a junior advisor, or a junior staffer, but all of his top advisors and his wife were telling him to get out. You're done. Get out. Had he dropped out then in 1976, he would never have been the nominee 4 years later. It was only seeing it through to the convention and fighting it out and losing by a handful of votes that positioned him for the nomination 4 years later. So Trump has that fighter instinct that you know, he's a brawler. This guy can't wait to take on the left. And Hillary Clinton must know at this point that all of her crimes are going to be delineated by the Republican candidate, every single one of them, in terms that people can understand.
I mean, I know that Trump and Reagan had had dinner at some dinners and had met each other. Do you know what Reagan thought of Trump, or did it ever come up?
Well, it's interesting. President Reagan, like President Nixon, who met Donald Trump in George Steinbrenner's private box at Yankee Stadium, both Reagan and Nixon urged Trump to run for public office. Now, in Nixon's case, he said, you know, Donald, you might want to take a look at the governor's office first. But Trump, frankly, is too big for the governor's office, or I should say the governor's office is too small for him. His focus has always been on national issues and international issues like trade. So, but it's interesting that two of the best politicians of the last 40 years both met Trump and urged him to run for public office.
Absolutely. But, you know, having Trump run and just be a governor, that's like Shamu at SeaWorld. It just doesn't fit. That's why it's animal torture, in my view, and I'm not even a PETA supporter. We'll be back in 70 seconds with one more segment with Roger Stone. Then it's your phone calls on this live Global Thursday edition. We started the term 1776 worldwide, popularized the term that an economist gave me. The answer to 1984, 1776. But now from the Financial Times of London to New Yorker magazine to you name it, they're saying Alex Jones, the mad prophet of the Tea Party, is spreading worldwide. And of course, Trump is now the big mega god of the movement. I mean, they use terms like that with a horrible infection. And the CFR says it's spreading worldwide. It's like they're having 1776 in Europe. Now 30, because they've got 30 members, want to leave. It was 8. I mean, they are panicking. Nationalism is exploding. Our terms are getting picked up everywhere. This is crazy, Roger. I mean, I'm telling you, Trump, myself, everybody, this is the zeitgeist. We ought to just be celebrating that populism is being reawoken. Your view on the Brexit, how big a deal is that?
It's enormous. It shows that the new world order is being overturned and that the people are wising up. They're no longer sheep being led to losing their freedoms and their economic prosperity. So, Alex, first of all, as you know, I keep a rule book. It's called Stone's Rules.
Yes.
And it guides everything. It's the rules for politics and rules for food and rules for dressing. And one of my favorite rules is white shirt, tan face equals confidence. I got to tell you, back from vacation, you look like $1 million today.
You're a sweetheart, man. I tell you, you're something else. You're the king of style. I tell you, your suit looks even better than Josh Brolin's in Hail Caesar. And I think that's almost the same suit, but that is a sharp suit.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. Today is, like I say, I'm on a...
You're writing. I understand you're in your artist mode.
So quickly before today's broadcast.
Getting back to Brexit in the few minutes we have left, and then other tidbits we should know about.
Well, the globalists are in full panic now because their lies are no longer working. Trump gave an excellent trade speech yesterday. He is going to continue, I think, to decimate Hillary Clinton. Every day, new things are learned. Today, there is a story based on a blockbuster new book by Dr. Jerome Corsi that Clinton Foundation funds were used to pay for a vacation for Chelsea, a foreign vacation, used to pay Huma Abedin on the side while she was theoretically a full-time government employee, used to pay all kinds of improper expenses to augment the lifestyle of the epically greedy Hillary Clinton.
Can she withstand all this corruption and the Secret Service agents coming out against her and saying she's a demon? I mean, how can she stand?
Well, first of all, we see the material and we probably think that it is getting wider distribution than is true. The Clintons are still very adept at using their spin machine.
Oh, they've had you banned everywhere. In fact, that's my last point for you. I'm really noticing this more than ever. They know Trump gives them ratings, so they show short clips that aren't powerful, out of context, and then talk about him, but don't let him be heard. Are you seeing that more and more on the TV?
Well, we can't complain about the coverage of his entire speeches by the two cable networks, but what you say is particularly true of CNN. There has been a sharp change in CNN's programming after Trump wrapped up the nomination. Prior to that, while I'm not saying that they were advocates or patrons in any way, their coverage was somewhat fairer. But now, I think the Clinton News Network has kicked into high gear, and therefore their greatest fear is that Trump will be heard, fully heard. And if he is fully heard, they will lose.
Roger, we got 30 seconds left, StoneZone.com. What other things are on your radar?
Well, we have to continue to look at the money situation. The gap between the Hillary super PACs and the pro-Trump super PACs is daunting. Hillary's got $50 million.
Listen, if you can't do it, because you're writing articles, I understand, and you do like 4 more minutes on the other side of this break, because I want to ask you about just a message to Trump saying he should spend his own money. I want to get your view on that. Can you stay 5 more minutes? All right, we'll be right back with Roger Stone, StoneZone.com. We sell both his latest best-selling books at InfoWarsStore.com, discounted, and that is Hillary's War on Women, that I know you know about, but give it to women that don't. He's got a few other big bombshells to lay on, folks. I was talking to him during the break, so let's get to this first, then the issue of Trump raising money, and then one other tidbit he wanted to get to. But I just sit there and monitor Fox, CNN, MSNBC, you name it, just kind of spot checking. And I saw that incredible speech he gave a few days ago, and it got almost no coverage. They would kind of misreport on what he'd done, or just, oh, yeah, I'm going to make better trade deals. No, it was Hillary's working for the Chinese. We're already in a trade war. The surrender is over. If Americans saw that, even brainwashed establishment liberals, you got to be for it. I mean, you know we're getting screwed over. And you know he's a great guy, because if he was a shill, he wouldn't give speeches like that. This is causing irrevocable danger for them. And I knew when I saw the speech, because it was, I guess, Monday or whatever, when I was still on air, and I saw it afterwards. I sat there with my mouth hanging open with the crew. We shot a video about it. Rob Dewitt, like, tears in his eyes, literally. It was so powerful and so real. Anti-New World Order. I mean, this was amazing. And then they just had little clips out of context, real milquetoast, didn't play a lot of large pieces of it. And so he's re-given the speech, I guess, today, because Stone brought that up. He said, yeah, they're trying to block this out. So I'm going to play basically that whole speech, some of his other speech, Sunday. And I think everybody should just really get these, send these to friends and family, really promote these. Drudge link to it, of course. You know, maybe Drudge talks about how they're blacking it out, put it back out. Because I'm telling you, what he's doing, in my humble view, is like absolute high noon to Count Dracula. Roger? Roger, is this high noon to Count Dracula, if we're able to get this info out to people? Are they blocking Trump's speech?
Well, they're attempting to. The problem is that was very easy to do in the 80s when the Clintons had their political heyday, because there were only three national networks. Cable TV was still in its infancy. The internet was not nearly as developed. But today, consumers, in this case voters, have so much access to information that the true story of Bill Clinton's sexual assaults and the fact that he's a sexual predator and the fact that Hillary ran the cover up, and it was Hillary who directed the campaign to threaten and bully and intimidate his victims, is going to become public. The facts about the death of Vince Foster. By the way, I don't think he was murdered, but I do think she ordered his body moved. We're going to learn the facts about the Clinton slush fund, the so-called Clinton Foundation, which is, you know, the largest international money laundering conspiracy in world history, Alex. This is maybe a $3 billion fraud now. So those kinds of blockbuster facts cannot be suppressed by a feeble, outdated, mainstream media.
I agree with you. We're going to play that clip after you leave us here in a few minutes for folks that just tuned in. Part of the speech, what I think is the most powerful part. But isn't the establishment media filled with hubris, fueled with arrogance? Aren't they at risk of totally discrediting themselves and actually completely collapsing? I mean, the numbers show they've gone from 11 or 12% a few years ago in AP polls of the public trusting mainstream media to 6%. I mean, do they understand how they're really self-immolating? And could this election, for better or worse, for Trump, really be the demarcation point of the death of the dinosaur media?
Well, it is conceivable, Alex. Never underestimate their arrogance and their belief in their own power. And sometimes they do not have a recognition that that power is dwindling. So they tend to mock what they can't understand, and they don't know that communications today is in the new age.
They're savages. It's
arrogant. Then secondarily, of course, they have fewer and fewer and fewer voters and listeners as media becomes less diffuse, and the less listeners and viewers they have, the less influence.
Sure, and by savages, they're playing an old 70s, 80s, 90s disinfo game with just blatant lies, and they don't understand they're fighting in a 21st century theater.
Well, and Trump understands how to garner publicity, free publicity in all mediums, in a way that no one in our lifetime knows how to do. He is the greatest showman who ever lived.
And he's broken on through to the other side. Let's look at money then. I mean, obviously that's a problem. I mean, I don't see it as bad. He said, I'm not going to take big money. He wasn't really clear about it, but okay, he did that in the primary. No one's ever done that and won. He did it. But, I mean, it's not bad for him to raise money as long as he sticks to his platform, right?
Well, I think a couple things. First of all, money is not going to decide this race, because no matter what Trump does, Hillary's campaign and the efforts of her wealthy patrons like Soros, they will always have more money. But hundreds of millions of dollars were spent against Trump in the primaries, and some well-crafted negative television ads were put up at velocities that should have an impact, but they simply haven't. The voters have wised up. So Trump needs enough money to be competitive. He doesn't need as much as she does, but he needs enough to fly the plane, to travel.
He needs the tactical, you know, to like, say she puts out a disinfo ad at 10 to 1. The truth trumps that, pun intended. He just puts out the truth to respond, and then that gives him the ability to beat her. Is that what you're saying?
I am. I also urge anybody who's trying to understand the mind of Donald Trump to carefully watch his Twitter feed. He has said some things about globalism and Americanism this week, which I think are a signal to every patriot that he gets it.
Amazing. I'm going to let you go, because I know you're busy. You just ran over from Trump Tower back to the house before you go back over in some meetings. But Roger Stone joining us, StoneZone.com. What was the other point during the break you wanted to make? There was one other thing you brought up.
Well, Alex, I get many, many patriots keep asking me what is happening with the Cleveland rally. You will remember that this began as the Stop the Steal rally. You and I and others were booked to speak. And then after Trump wrapped up the nomination, we converted it to the American Unity rally. The city of Cleveland put forward a series of restrictions on our free speech, our right to assemble, told us what we could and could not do, guaranteed herding our people into a penned-off area with leftist thugs. So you would have had violence. Right now, so we went to federal court, Citizens for Trump, a fine grassroots organization that folks should sign up in, that is distinct from the campaigns, but very well run and very effective, was the plaintiff. The left-wing ACLU represented us because they agreed that the restrictions by the city were unconstitutional. We won that lawsuit. They changed the safety perimeter from 4 miles out from the stadium to 1 mile, far more reasonable. But they continue to stall on our permit. Now they're telling us we need a union-approved soundstage, that we need special city permits for. What's going on here is the Democratic machine that runs Cleveland knows that the longer they can delay our ability to both raise money to pay for and rally bodies for this rally, they're enhancing the chances that it will not be a success. So they intend to give us our permits, I think, knowing that we'll go litigate again if we must, but that in the end they'll make care of our approvals so late that we will be precluded from having hundreds.
Yeah, they're running the clock on us, so everybody just be there. We're protesting for free speech. We're protesting against globalism. We're protesting against the Soros scum that's going to be bust in, and everybody better be there, okay? I mean, this is people talk about 1776, and you want to march on Washington and all this stuff. This is where you march. This is the fight. This is where everyone needs to be there, period. We're exercising our free speech, period. We need the bikers, everybody there. Don't wait for orders from headquarters. Go to the sound of the political guns. Roger?
Delighted to be with you, and I agree. So if you have plans to Cleveland, we'll see you there. I actually have a book signing at the Barnes & Noble in Cleveland for Clinton's War on Women, where I hope to see many old friends and some new ones. Alex, I know you're going to be speaking at a couple of events, plus you'll have a whole crew there. I'm really looking forward to this.
I'm looking forward to buying you dinner, buddy. Thank you so much, Roger Stone.
Thanks, Alex.
Let's go out to break. I'm going to come back directly to your calls in the next segment with a little bit of that speech where he talks about her being a foreign agent, where we already have surrendered. We're not going to surrender anymore. This is the speech Hillary's afraid of. This is the speech he gave a few days ago. He gave it again today. Here it is.
Hillary Clinton and her campaign of fear will try to spread the lie that these start a trade war. We already have a trade war, and we're losing badly, badly. She has it completely backwards. Hillary Clinton unleashed a trade war against the American worker when she supported one terrible deal after another, from NAFTA to China to South Korea. It doesn't matter. No matter where she went, The American worker was hurt, and you will be hurt worse than ever before if she becomes president of the United States. That I can tell you. A Trump administration will end that war by getting a fair deal for the American people and the American worker. The era of economic surrender will finally be over. It'll be over. You're not going to see it anymore. Although, I can't guarantee it, because after me, they'll probably start doing it again. But we will have 4 and maybe 8 great, great, great productive years, and we'll never go back, and we'll make sure we never go back. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
You know, this is so important. I'm going to come back and take your calls, but when we post this to YouTube and places, I'm going to put the rest of the speech on here, because this is the speech Hillary is scared of. This is a Donald Trump speech they don't want you to see. And it just gets more and more powerful, and it's all true, 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 true. Okay? This is amazing. I feel so good that I endorsed Donald Trump a year ago. I'm Alex Jones, your host. Matthew, Jason, David, Mike, Buckley, and many others. We're going to your phone calls right now on any issue you wish to break down or get into. Jason in the great north of Canada. You're on the air. Welcome.
Hi, Alex.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I had an idea regarding Trump, if he needs funding. And I just wanted to share it with you. I don't know if it's a good idea or not. You know, I don't understand all the election rules or anything like that, but... if Trump needs money, how about they set up some sort of donation type setup online or whatever with a fixed amount. So either, you know, a dollar donation or like $17.76, something like that. Then what you do is you raise money. All the donors, you can't really call them lobbyists at $17 or $1. And you also have a very accurate count of the people supporting Trump that you can use against the false narrative of Hillary's success.
That's a good idea. I appreciate your call, Jason. I'm going to go through a lot of calls quickly here, but let me just briefly comment. I didn't get Roger to talk about this. We talked about it in a lengthy conversation Sunday afternoon, and this was not off record, this part, because I have notes here, that Trump won't sit there and do what Adelson wants to get the $100 or $200 million he's been offered, so that's withdrawn. To a great extent, that's newsworthy. And these other people are offering big money, and he just won't agree to do stuff when they tell him. So he's not getting big money, and that's just another endorsement of the guy. It's like, wow, that never happens to the presumptive nominee. That said, though, the smart money is on the fact that Trump needs to just not just self-fund and spend, it's $55 million now, it was $45 of his own money. If he says he's got $10 billion, that's not just the assets of his buildings and golf courses and stuff. I know he's always used other people's money and investments, made them money and made him money. That's fine. That's ethical. You're running for the United States during a global crisis of world government. You will be George Washington 21st century if you deliver and stop this. I mean, most of these guys are about to die with cancer, and then they give all their money to some charity or something that the globalists grab and use. You know, don't be like Carnegie or Mellon or the Fords or whatever. The word is Trump does have probably $15, $20 million in assets, but it liquid, maybe a couple billion. And I don't know if that's wrong, but that's how it usually works, okay? I know he wants to keep some money to battle the war chest. That's smart. Spend a billion. And I know he's a smart guy. He thinks he can somehow self-fund. It isn't happening so far, you know, or small donations. And I think Trump should just say something like, I'm giving $10 million. Will you match it? And then people do give $17.76. So we could call this video right here, as we're live, a plan for Trump to raise $1 billion released. I mean, that's a smart plan. You know, he starts giving a $10 million a week of his own money. He goes out, pledges it, has the check, and then it's a publicity event. And as he goes to these states, he says, I need all of you to go to my political website. And he gives out the URL. I need you all to give $17.76 and invest in your children's future and our whole future. That's what I'm doing. And I'm giving back now. I know it's very hard for people that are able to amass these giant fortunes to just put money out there without other people being part of it. So I think that's probably the way for him to do this. But I think that says everything. I mean, look, they've got it all written where special interests can come in and manipulate stuff, but they don't want rich people who could be mavericks like a Ross Perot or a Donald Trump to do this. And that's the other issue. We know they threatened Ross Perot's family, threatened to kill his wife. He said the Bushes did it. I mean, it came out in the news. He gave a press conference. Almost nobody covered it. Yes, my wife and daughter were threatened, and I'm done. But you're crazy if you go with this Bush, all I'm telling you right now. By the way, NAFTA didn't get, you're hearing a giant second sound. You want to lose your jobs? I've got polls out where 37% of employers say if things go to $15 an hour minimum wage, they're going to lay people off. You'll have to. Those are entry-level jobs where you're hiring some teenager for $6-7 an hour. They're not even worth it to train them at that level. I mean, you got to bring in, say, 5-6 interns before you find a couple that are good. We just do paid interns, but then people better work immediately, and we find some really good people. But usually interns are so dumb in college that they go get a job at a radio station, just kind of lazy. Can I do anything? Get you any lunch? Oh, what do I do? Man, I went an intern in radio. I was like, let me help you cut those ads. Let me learn to splice that. Back then, we're still cutting the film, the tape. And let me get into sales. Yeah, let me go into sales meetings. Let me go to a sales lunch with you. Let me get into sales. Let me see what I can do. Yeah, I want to get on air. Yeah. Then, of course, the jealousy kicks in of the salespeople a year later when you're making more money than they are. And you're younger, you're better looking, you got top ratings, better than Howard Stern had at night. He was on the same station as me. I had better ratings at night than Howard Stern had locally. They were paying like $300,000 a year for a show. And they just flipped. It was really weird. They got a new manager. They were like so jealous. That's what I started to figure out. A lot of people don't like success, really. Hold on. We're going to go right back to your calls. Nathan, Trance, Margaret, Mika, Buckley, and others. Let's go to Mika in California. You're on the air worldwide.
Hi, Alex. I know you like to cover CPS stories about the CPS taking away children needlessly.
Well, I don't like to cover it, and quite frankly, I kind of shy away from it because it gets me really freaked out. But yes, we do cover it sometimes.
Cover it better and more than most. So,
yes.
One thing that I've noticed is that no one has really asked the question, why have the children of the San Bernardino shooter and the Orlando shooter not been taken away from their families?
Holy mackerel. I didn't even know that was the case. Yeah, they can take your kids away for, some cases, yelling at them, they claim, or letting your 10-year-old play in the backyard at 6 o'clock in the afternoon if you go to get a pizza. Everything we did as kids. But I guess your kid says, I want brownies, and the word brown is racist now or whatever. The police get called. You're telling me, I didn't know that, they didn't take the kids away from those freaks?
If they have, I haven't heard about it, and that's what's concerning me. They can take it away if you smoke pot, but when your family members shoot 50 people, you know, then the kids go to the grandparents.
I was about
to... Or the wife.
I was about to add, it's apples and oranges, but Bill Clinton's the one that set a quota where every year, if the locals get federal money, the quota on the number of kids taken has to increase, just like it was Bill Clinton came up with minimum sentencing, and then black people worship him when he's totally a known racist. I mean, he did have a baby with a black lady. But the point is, in the Deep South stuff, it's like a culture to feed on black people. It's like Tulia, Texas, where, you know, 90-something percent of the prison population was black. And then the local town whites actually owned the private prison. They were planting drugs on the remaining, like, 85-year-old black people with no criminal record just to put them in prison and take their property. I mean, there is that type of racism that goes on. And then when it goes on, nothing's done about the real bona fide that you can have through a police state. But, yes, sometimes social workers do a great job. I know social workers that help old people do a wonderful job. Sometimes they work with realtors to know when somebody's old and sick to help take their house. So it does attract predators. There's a lot of child molesters that get into it. And absolutely, they let Muslims do stuff to their women and their kids that's illegal because it's, quote, their culture. And so I should look into that. I mean, are you sure of that, or are you asking that question?
No, this is something that I haven't heard anyone follow up on, and I would love to hear you follow
up. Well, I know this. What type of freaks would go kill their coworkers for Allah and then not, and do that, I mean, and leave your kids behind? That's a great point. But again, this is the freakish behavior. I appreciate those points. And I'll tell you, it's the worst I've ever seen it. Even in British newspapers now, they won't say Islamic terror. And I sat there yesterday and some this morning watching the news, and they would not call it Islamic terror or jihad or even ISIS. Okay, I mean, they won't even say who takes credit for stuff now. You got to dig that ISIS took credit for the attack in Turkey that killed 40-something people, and the bombs, the machine guns. Oh, guns are illegal, but it still happened. And but they say, we've got to have more checkpoints and more of your rights taken because this happened in Turkey. It's very, 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 very frustrating. I want to go to more of your calls, and then I've got to get to this clip. It was Matt pointed this out this morning. He said, you got to play this, Alex. And he's absolutely right. I'm really bad about not getting to these bombshell clips. Morning Joe blasts Loretta Lynch for privately meeting with Bill Clinton amid email probe, MSNBC. Meanwhile, Lynch said no conflict of interest in Clinton investigation despite Obama endorsing of Hillary. Ladies and gentlemen, it is totally illegal when the Justice Department is over the FBI and the FBI is involved in a criminal, admittedly, investigation of Hillary to have her meet with the Clintons. I mean, this is unbelievable. But it's just like Obama saying, I'm going to open the borders up to illegals and not even test them for diseases. You don't even care about the illegals? No, it's about just like, I need another book or something so I could smash something together. Somebody bring me another book, please. It's just taking America and Latin America and Asia and all these poor people and just slamming our heads together. They're not overrunning the evil gringo white people to get us. That's on the surface. It's just slam us together, like conking our heads together. Thank you. I mean, you want to see what the New World Order's doing with their policies to Mexico and the U.S.? You think Mexico or the U.S. is winning? No. Nobody's winning except the stinking globalists who just, like buzzards, they want rotten, dead societies they can feed on. Now, let's go back to your phone calls. I'm going to play that clip. Let's talk to Nathan in Arizona. Nathan, you're on the air. Thank you for holding.
Hey, Alex, first-time caller, been a listener for probably about 2 years now. I'm originally a Cleveland native, living out here in Phoenix, Arizona now. But I started things from my childhood. I kind of put together when I was growing up. A good friend of mine, actually my best friend, their family hosted the Clintons at their private house for a campaign for one of the Democratic, I believe it was a governor running at the time back in 2000. But they hosted the Clintons at their private residence. And the guy, he's a Arab American, a Syrian American. And I was researching just as of late, and he was comes out to be one of the largest Democratic supporters the state of Ohio as far as fundraising.
Oh, yeah, listen, here's the deal. So, the Muslims are pouring money into everybody. And, I mean, again, it's a bunch of foreign interests. It's sickening.
What I was thinking is, you know, this may be why that the Trump campaign is having some problems in Cleveland getting things, you know, going. And just from growing up in Cleveland, I know how kind of backdoor, mobbish type under-the-table dealings there is. And especially, you know, when you got somebody.
Sure. Well, I want to explain something to everybody. When they act like thugs and try to block us and we win the federal lawsuit and then they still claim they're going to back off but just give us a new BS plan, we're winning. We're making them act like the thugs they are. And we're showing up. And we're going to be mental, cultural, and physical giants compared to the drooling idiot renamobs of, you know, the slaves of Sauron. The slaves of Soros. And that was actually a Freudian slip. I literally just said that. That was not on purpose. The slaves of the Nazi collaborator dirtbag. So I'll be there. We're all going to be there. And we're going to have airplanes flying around Hillary for prison. I got a bunch of tricks up my sleeve, so get ready.
And, we had to go get water for Bill Clinton because he actually wouldn't drink any water that was, I think it was Evian at the time, that they had for the party, the fundraiser, and we actually had to go get him some kind of different kind of water.
What kind of water did he want? What kind of water did he want?
Well, actually, he wanted something American made, which I can respect that. But if you want to get better, you know, political correctness, you know, wouldn't that be racist? I mean,
well, let's expand on it. He probably had a particular brand he wanted. Was it?
No, I believe it was just something that they had in the Cleveland area. Now that I remember, just something local.
Yeah, interesting. Well, that how did Bill act? Was he nice and friendly?
Hey, and the thing too that we had a joke going on because the guy Tony George that was hosting it, his wife actually was on Baywatch, so we had an ongoing joke. I had my friend. I said, "You better watch Bill with your mom. You know, don't want something happening."
Yeah. All right, good to hear from you, my friend. Thank you, Nathan. Let's go ahead now and take a call from Buckley in Missouri. Thanks for holding her on the air.
Thanks for having me, Alex. I appreciate it.
Thank you. I just
wanted to introduce you and your listeners to a fantastic film that will inspire our faith in our common future. The title of the film is Back to Eden, and it was directed and produced by two young gals, Dana Richardson and Sarah Zintz. It's about organic gardening and how you can grow the most nutritious vegetables that you've ever seen.
Absolutely. I ought to carry that video. Yeah. I've heard of it. I ought to have them on. We're really going to be moving into self-sufficiency because it's about getting ourselves personally partially disconnected from the system. Nobody can do it totally, but it's about starting the process of having the hobbies of horticulture, of gardening, of farming, of metallurgy, combat. Firearms training. Go ahead.
Yeah, this guy has, his name is Paul Gauci, and after years of backbreaking toil in the ground, ravaged by the effects of the man-made growing techniques and systems, Paul has discovered a taste of what God has intended for mankind in the Garden of Eden. In this film titled Back to Eden, you can buy the DVD at backtoedenfilm.com, or you can watch it for free on Vimeo.com. Just
good.
Search for Back to Eden.
Well, thank you for the plug. Anything else, Buckley? Are you a producer, or do you just really like the film?
Well, I like the film. I'm using the My Patriot Supply Seed Vault seeds. I've been doing this technique. This is my second year now, and it's working great. I've thrown my tiller away. I'll never have to till the soil again. It's just a fantastic way.
Well, let me tell you, their film, I've heard about it. I need to watch it. I need to buy it in bulk, sell it with all the seeds we've got, because I really want to push that culture. That sounds like a great idea, Buckley. Thank you so much. I appreciate that call. Trace, as far away as the computer screen. Is that Trace? That's Trace in New Jersey. Go ahead.
Hi, how you doing?
Good, my friend.
Alex, I've been a 20-year listener, and I'm 26 years old, just to give you a scope of it.
So you've been listening since you were a little kid. I mean, who was it in your family? Would they have you listen to shortwave? Or?
No, I'm just a young hacker. I did my own pirating. And,
sure, I must have misheard you. I thought you said you're 22 years old. You've been listening for 20 years. I must have misheard that.
I'm 26. I'm sorry.
All right. I guess you had a little trouble with your audio. Go ahead.
Okay. I was calling because I wanted to speak on the globalist weapons and their newest methods of invading every bit of our lives. And one thing that most people haven't even really recognized, this is something that I recognized after my father had been in the military for 20 years, and I joined when I was old enough. I found there were some things that the people should know, but I couldn't speak on them because of my clearance. Even to this day, I still can't say exactly what they are, but I can give you a taste of something that I found odd. Yesterday, I was just riding my bike coming from an interview, and my phone did something really odd. It started to dial some numbers that I've never seen.
Sure.
And I don't even know.
And then once they do that to you, they can then claim those are numbers of watch, and so then they can legally open up an investigation on you, or your phone's been hacked by somebody else. But let me give everybody the big secret about classification. Our government, since the National Security Act in 1947, has classified hundreds of millions of news articles that were in the newspaper. That means their own people can't talk about it in the government. So they classify it when they show you they're spying on us illegally and stuff so that you feel like you can't ever talk about something that was illegal, even though the illegal program had congressional funding. You understand? So they tend to classify general program systems, but the pieces they had to build it had to be approved and run through and weren't classified. That's why I don't need Cy Hirsch, or I don't need Steve Pachinik, or I don't need Tim Kennedy to tell me any stuff that's going on with things. I've already reverse engineered it all, and it's all in white papers. Or I can go read what the globalists wrote in the 50s, and they've done everything they wanted that far. Now I see the next phase of what they want to do, and my God, if they get this in, I mean, 20, 30 years, maybe sooner, we're all dead. I mean, they plan to set up a total robot takeover, get every form of the economy controlled, get everything actuary down, and then just start bioweaponing whoever's left. I'm sorry, though. What do you think's going on with your phone, my friend?
Honestly, I know exactly what it is. That's what disturbs me, because it was a system that I worked on with in the military.
Okay, well, was I correct, or was it a thing to then geolocate it?
Yes, you're right. It is a geolocation.
Sir, this is as I told you. That was in the 1996 Telecommunications Act. By law, by 2000, all, quote, new phones have to have that. But I don't understand the reason you say it was randomly dialing numbers. Unless the cell tower, it was sending out a code to basically integrate that into a local template of some local governmental or substrata group that was jacking into that data, not pulling it off the main central NSA control panel.
It was encryption. The way I know it was encryption was because these numbers weren't phone numbers. They were codes. They were codes that are used on certain systems that...
Sure, but I'm saying you were seeing a readout probably. I mean, I'm not the engineer. There's too many different programs, but it was hitting your phone with the commands is what you're saying?
Yeah,
sure, but all I'm telling you is that's not secret, though. I know you were in a secret program. They told you that was secret. They're operating. Anthony Gucciardi is coming up, going to be anchoring the fourth hour. I'm going to do 5 minutes the next hour, take a few calls from Margaret and... Matthew and Derek, a few others have been holding the longest. But I want to get into the unprecedented corruption of the Justice Department. And I know that's obvious, but it's never been more brazen, hubris-filled, arrogant, naked, out in the open. I mean, this is like you come home at 6 o'clock and a guy has your wife under him naked on your couch in front of your children committing the act of sex. And they both get up and say, no, we're not having sex. I mean, it's that ridiculous at this point. I mean, Hillary took billions at her foundation from foreign governments. It's totally illegal. If I did that, I'd be arrested, and I should be. So let's go to this first clip where this is just unbelievable. Morning Joe blasts Loretta Lynch for privately meeting with Bill Clinton. I mean, even those guys know this is just unbelievable. Amid the email probe, meanwhile, Lynch said a few months ago there's no conflict of interest in Clinton investigation despite Obama endorsement of Hillary. I mean, that's ridiculous. So Loretta Lynch met Bill Clinton privately on Tuesday morning in Phoenix on her plane after he boarded. My God, that's like if a judge is investigating, there's an investigation, looking to indict a mob boss, and they meet on their plane. I mean, this is so illegal. I mean, this is crazy. Go ahead and play the clip, please.
Attorney General says the meeting with the former president was unplanned and that she and Bill Clinton never discussed the email investigation. We're told the two just happened to be at the Phoenix airport at the same time when the former president boarded her plane.
What's the word, Joe? Optics?
Boy, this is beyond optics. This is unbelievable. This is the good news is it gives Rush Limbaugh material for 3 hours today. It gives him a lot to talk about.
He's not going to have to research
that. Specifically to sit down and meet with her and talk about.
She's the Democratic Attorney General. He's a former Democratic president. Perfectly reasonable to talk, except under these circumstances.
By the way, stop that. But back it up 10 seconds. I don't normally make physical comments about people all the time unless I really hate them like Hillary. What's up with Scarborough? And he literally, it's like in Mars Attacks when the alien looks like a chick with a beehive haircut. you know, to cover up its big alien head. I don't believe that aliens are secretly running the planet. I was joking about that yesterday, but I don't know, guys. Is he covering up like a cone head or something there? There's a shot where he's looking straight under the camera where he looks like Bozo the Clown. Can you find that part? I mean, I'm not the best looking guy in the world either. Come on, you know. Listen, I mean, the ladies think I am, but I'm just joking. The point is, he looks like a space alien, man. What the? And then he's got the war criminal's daughter next to him, Mika. Okay, I just can't handle it anymore. Briefly, I'm going to come back and take some of your calls. I've got where she said there's no conflict of interest, but we need to play that video. I may. Don't forget, biggest special that we've really ever offered on preparedness items across the board. It is 20 to 40% off on all the storable foods. It is 20% off Survival Shield Nation 9X2. 20% off Alexa Pure Water Filters and Air Purifiers. That is such a great deal. It's a 4th of July special. It's going to run through, I guess, next Tuesday or so. And we need the capital. These aren't just great products you need to fund our media operations and what we're doing. So get stuff you need, great prices, really high quality, and fund the info war, whether it's non-GMO seeds, heirloom seeds, or whether it's storable foods, or whether it's Hillary for Prison shirts. They're all available at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com for the nutraceuticals. And you can also always call toll-free if you've got any questions or comments or want to order or ask about specials, 888-253-3139. And I tend to forget, we have free shipping on orders of $50 or more and 10% off on top of all the discounts when you sign up for the Vaunted Auto Ship. All at InfoWarsStore.com. Hour number 4, 70 seconds away. Some stations don't carry it. InfoWars.com/show to find the continuum. And a special video is airing in the next hour. I'll just leave it at that. We're not, like, looking for these articles where they're trying to turn everything into supposed racism. They're there every day where a kid says brownies. I want brownies for dessert. They say that must be racist, so the police are called in New Jersey. Or somebody holds up a sign, F ISIS, so the police come saying it's a hate crime against a loving group. I mean, it's just unbelievable that we have gotten to this point. Meanwhile, guns from Fast and Furious show up in the Paris attack. That's up on InfoWars.com. Let's go to Matthew in New York. You're on the air. Thank you for calling.
Hey, Alex. Matt with Facebook here. Hey, I've been thinking about how Trump could pull off his tariff threats. And when I'm discussing it with friends, they immediately think the plans are too risky and they'd rather sit back and rot like we are today. But what do you think if when he gets in office, he makes a statement that, like on July 4th, 2018, USA will start to enforce tariff on imports in countries who are in violation. But before he does all that, his staff creates a comprehensive list of all the industries that are lacking in the USA and start like a $1 trillion grant program to start to encourage Americans, not the elite, not people who currently own businesses, to start businesses so that by July 4th, 2018, or whatever date he actually sets, we'll be prepared and we won't have to.
That's right. That's right. I mean, it's in the campaign. He's saying he's not going to let China have these manipulated internal tariffs that are illegal, and then he's going to leverage and get better deals. Well, that's very easy to do because the globalist plan is to deindustrialize us and to make us dependent. That's why the deals are all so horrible and one-sided, is because it's meant to be that way. The only thing they were supposed to protect under globalism, it's the whole rollerball scenario where, you know, this country's over this, and, you know, one's over energy, one's over media, one's over military, one's over manufacturing. There's been a deal made. China's been cheating. And I'm against the globalist deal, where they get to be the world economic power and have all the rare earth minerals and the ports, and then we get to be the military power, and then we counterbalance each other. But, of course, it's a double cross from the beginning, but that's the essence of what globalism is. So, absolutely. And, plus, China's already been double-crossing the Anglo-Americans, so that's why there's a little more support in some sectors that are more patriotic of the power structure to let Trump get in and do this anyways, because the elite realize they're being screwed over. And the Chinese are like, just come on over and live here, like George Soros and people like that. Just come over here and retire and, you know, just we're going to win, so just go with us. I appreciate your call. Let's talk. It was a good point. Talk to Derek in the great state of Tennessee, the volunteer state. Go ahead, Derek.
Hey there, Alex.
Hey, bro.
I've just got one question I've had this question on my mind for quite a while, and I really don't know any other platform to maybe get noticed with it. You know, I've got one question, and that's Donald Trump could ask this, the American people and the U.S. government, and that is, how can anyone, force a free people such as ourselves to purchase an imaginary product like Obamacare from a third-party profiteering entity, the insurance company?
which is predominantly foreign. I mean, it's a foreign global tax. Our political elite have rented us out like a cheap whore who's got cigarette burns all over and pus dripping out of her eyes. I mean, they've already beat us with coat hangers. But now we're so sick and, you know, feeble, and basically they're renting us out to a vampire that wants to drink what's left of our precious bodily fluids, to quote Jack T. Ripper. I mean, it's such an galactic supreme overlord screw job that I totally, absolutely agree with you. I don't have any words to describe how redonkulous it is. And then Trump just gets up and says, I'm going to make the vampires, you know, get off of you for a little while. They're like, how dare you? Do you see how sparkly their white teeth are? I mean, it's just amazing.
Yeah, like I say, I just, that's the one question. If it would come out of Donald Trump's mouth, you know, maybe we get enough people behind us and it'd be that Leonidas spear moment at Xerxes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Brother, good point, Derek. I'm going to come back and finish up real fast with a few more calls and hand the baton to Anthony Gucciardi. And then he got a special video coming at the bottom of the hour. I still haven't aired the Rob New video. It's a special report. But it's up on Infowars.com. I'm going to retweet it out right now. How the global elite have been caught red-handed admitting they're going to use food as a global weapon. That's one more reason I'm saying right now, 20 to 40% off, one of the best specials you've ever done. Very hard to get the maker of this let us do it, but it's available right now on Infowarsstore.com. We now take you live to Austin, Texas, in a desperate attempt to fend off the globalists. Would you like to know more? Anthony Gucciardi, riding shotgun with me in this hour. Tell me, my friend, what you have coming up, but I'm going to finish up with a few news stories and clips and hand the baton to you.
When they say it's a slow news day, that just means there's more time to research stuff that no one else noticed. Like this says, Apple patent could prevent, quote, illegal iPhone recording. The patent could prevent iPhone cameras from being able to record in concerts and classified facilities.
And they've always wanted that, just like drones we buy suddenly won't even fly, you know, near areas they don't want downtown. This is the pre-programming of everything to control society. It's a total nightmare scenario. I said this 10 years ago. Save your old cameras, save your old equipment, because in the future, you'll have to have that to be able to videotape anywhere. They could turn them off nationwide if they want.
I mean, who's to say what illegal is, right? I mean, what if you're out and the police come and you want to film something, but it's illegal? You can't film the police.
Oh, no. The police have already tried to get patents. And again, I'm not against the police themselves, but I'm against Big Brother, to where they can citywide turn stuff off or in a certain protest area. Exactly. That's outrageous.
Yeah, there's no stopping it. There's a bunch of news articles on ZDNet and tech sites. Apple granted patent for a way to stop iPhones from taking photos or, quote, sensitive locations. So it means nothing. It's a branch all term.
And we show up at the NSA in San Antonio right next to a Walmart. They're spying on us. We're videotaping their front gate. They come and say, you can't do that. There's no law.
And you know what
also
happens?
We're the press. You're illegally spying on us while the border's wide open.
Yeah, exactly. But we've been out before shooting stuff, and security people will come, oh, there's our logo in the background. There's a bank or something. You can't shoot here. It's illegal, right? It's really not. You can shoot whatever you want. But in their words, oh, you can't have our logo in it anymore. You're near a bank. So what if they just say, well, you can't shoot near this bank anymore?
And when we comply, it creates this false illusion and delusion. That's why, whether it's a security guard, whether it's a code enforcer or a police officer, don't let people give you orders that violate your own rights. I remember a few years ago when we were still putting out the magazine, it was a success, but in the aggregate, not as successful as digital. So I got rid of it. It was just taking up too much time. But I was handing out 50,000 free magazines over a week of South by Southwest. We hired official teams that do it for everybody else, for restaurants, bars, you name it. And they had the code enforcers come and say, you can't do this. I checked the code and I said, no, that's illegal. We're not setting up vendor stuff, whatever. You can't stop us. They ordered the cops to arrest our people, and the Austin Police Department said no, to their credit, because then I went down there to protest it, and the cops were like, yeah, no, it's just outrageous. But that shows who the Chronicle that and Lewis Black, who owns South by Southwest, what they think of America. These are dangerous fascists.
Well, I mean, obviously, and also look at this. Majority of Americans oppose political correctness. I like this article from Paul Watson's on InfoWars. Common sense defies decades of media and entertainment industry re-education. I know you talked about this a little bit, but what's interesting is I think if they rephrase the question in the poll question was, which is closer? Is there more political correctness in the United States, or is there too much prejudice? They should have just said, do you support political correctness? But even though they said it in such a way, 51% of Americans thought political correctness had gone too far in comparison to prejudice going too far. So if they would have said, do you support political correctness, I bet it would have been way more. But even though it was kind of like a tricky, almost loaded question, still the majority of Americans say no. Political correctness is more prevalent than actual prejudice.
And what it is cult language brainwashing to induce everyone into a totalitarian system of total language control beyond 1984. Thank you, Anthony. We'll hand the baton to you in a moment. Now, folks, I've made films on this. I have talked about this probably 3,000 times since the TSA was established 15 years ago. I have always exposed it. We've been dead on. I remember seeing the TSA when they were getting congressional funding in 2002, about to become a cabinet-level group underneath Homeland Security. I remember watching a two-hour C-SPAN that we actually played clips of on air. I wish I could find it. Somebody should go research, because all the archives it was Homeland Security was becoming that national post and in the cabinet, but TSA was about the national takeover in the two-hour discussion. So somebody should go find that. And Governor Ridge was the head then, and they were licking their chops about how soon there'll be checkpoints on highways, bus terminals, roads. Everything will be infrastructure protection, not just bridges and dams and nuclear power plants, and that soon you'll have to get government approval to have a job through the TSA. And then you started seeing them on the streets and the checkpoints and the mission creep and high schools using TSA for proms. And then the FBI said, we're going to have checkpoints at malls in case terrorists hit. So you can't call it Islamic terror. You bring in the Islamic terror. You let the Islamic terror strike the Orthodox Islamic mainline religion of peace. You tell the public it's not Islamic. You can't say that. And the media is so cult-like under political correctness, they won't say it. And now they're doing it. Oh my gosh, you saw Turkey. We've got to put checkpoints. They actually said when you enter the airport or maybe the parking lot or maybe at the entrance to the overall airport on the freeway. You heard me right. And all it'll be is more and more and more and more and more checkpoints. And they even admit they're just going to keep them all now. And then if you're a good little globalist, you get let right through. But if you're not, oh, sorry, it's going to take 8 hours. This is the end of free travel, the end of being open. So I drew a little picture here for TV viewers. Let me describe this for radio listeners. Let's just say this is a normal terminal here. I just scribbled this while Anthony was talking. And let's say this is the old classic thing you go through where you come into the airport and you go to the ticket machines or whatever, or you go to the tellers, and then you get your ticket, and then you just come over here and you put your stuff on the line and you take your shoes off and get trained how to be a slave. Then it goes to the metal detectors and the naked body scanners that shirt off makes all the money off of, and you've got a big crowd of people, you know, a couple hundred of them all lined up here, and a terrorist wants to hit a dense group of people with a bomb so that it kills hundreds, kills the maximum amount, you know, their bomb with nails or whatever, BBs all jacketed under broken glass, boom. Oh, so let's just move it here so they don't hit here. But now it's the same checkpoint right here. Now they're just going to blow this up. Okay, well, let's just move it out here to the parking lot then, you know, where we've got all the cars. And they'll put a fence up around it. They already have this set up. I mean, Austin Bergstrom just built this as a newer airport, and it's already set up to be a prison. And then now you go through a checkpoint here and get searched. Oh, but the terrorists would just blow that up. Okay, well, now we'll just go down the highway. And you're like, that doesn't make any sense. You just need to stop folks coming in or profile people with terrorist connections and allow them to be rolled up. Oh, no, 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 no. Because then you can't indict with suspicion all 330 million people. So it's the criminal government at the top that's working with the Islamics, that's bought and paid for by Saudi Arabia, that is letting Saudi Arabia build hundreds of mosques a year in the U.S. that they pay for with their radical form of Islam that is Orthodox Islam. This is 2 plus 2 equals 4. It's not even that. It's 1 plus 1 equals 2. It's not even that. It's just... how many fingers am I holding up? 5. I mean, there is no debating this. And so, oh, we're going to let the illegals come in, not even check if they have TB or all these other diseases, scabies, you name it. We're going to put them in school. We're going to let your kids get it. It's a form of hospitality. You're like, how about treating the illegals? Nope. Sorry. Oh, later we'll treat them. It'll be taxpayer expense. So it is a collapse economy. It is the sickest thing you could ever imagine. And it's a war on logic, because these criminals know that they have got to destroy logic and common sense to win their endgame. And they dream of making your kids a bunch of lazy, stupid jellyfish with worthless educations so they'll conform with the system and be socially engineered, where you'll get your precariat paycheck every month on top of your job. Your job won't be enough to allow you to survive. You'll have to have the supplemental income. That's the model, as Walmart said, where we pay you too little to live, but you're allowed under law to get food stamps and some other welfare. So you're actually working as a slave, but you got to get money as welfare to survive. And now you got to have inoculations. This is what they're already doing in Australia. This is the plan here. You've got to go to the social training we want. You got to do national compulsory service, not in the military, but in new domestic Stasi-style creepazoid groups. This is all being set up. It's all happening. This is it. To where no matter how much money you got, you're going to have to serve the system. Total cult brainwashing. This is so pathetically evil. And everything they do is about getting you off the land, getting you into controlled areas, getting you into the system, getting, I mean, I'm totally going more and more analog in my life. I'm disconnecting more and more. I come in to fight in the Matrix, inside, bathed in electromagnetic radiation and lights and all this. It's just like being tortured in here for 4 hours. I'm much smarter when I'm not being, you know, blaring lights in my eyes. But you know what I'm doing? I love it. It's even hurt my eyesight. I don't care. I love it. But the point is, if you cannot be part of this, it's a luxury not to. It's a luxury to have a garden. It's a luxury to have a little piece of land. It's a luxury to carve wood. It's a luxury to work on your own carburetor. It's a luxury to prune your own roses. It's a luxury to spend time with your kids on a hike. Everything the globalists are selling is death and lies and fraud. Everything trendy is pure evil. To hurt you and your family, period. Now, before I go any further, speaking of that, I'm going to hand the baton to Gucciardi. We're running one of the biggest specials ever because I think everybody should get prepared. Everybody should get ready. 20 to 40% off on InfoWars Select Storable Foods. I normally do this once a year or so. I did it a few months ago. But because things are so serious, I was able to call the producer of InfoWars Select, which is my Patriot. We sell their full spectrum as well. It's the same stuff, private labeled. We're able to go even lower, the lowest prices out there. This is the lowest you're going to find anywhere. 4th of July special, 20-40% off, InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsSelect.com takes you right to the page. 20% off Alexa Pure Water Filters, 20% off Alexa Pure Air Filters. Those are huge deals. 20% off Survival Shield Nation Iodine, which you just don't need during a radiological disaster. The bad halogens are in your body, folks, and we absorb into glands if you don't have this. And most iodine is bound with other garbage and it's not absorbable. Just like most selenium isn't organic and it's not bioavailable. It's not uploadable. We have the stuff that is. Synthetic B12 doesn't do diddly jack frickin' squat. Almost no one sells true organic plant-derived systems like Secret 12. We do. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. Take advantage of these 4th of July mega specials now. Anthony Gucciardi, straight ahead with your phone calls, tons of news, and a special video.
I want to be crazy, crazy like Alex Jones.
Oh, man.
And have enough gumption without a presumption to know what's going on. Then I can throw bananas at the global clowns and hear aristocratic moans. I want to be crazy, crazy like Alex Jones. I went looking one day on the internet just to see what I could find. When I heard this talk show maniac, he was proudly speaking his mind. It's real wild, but the more I heard it, made a whole lot of sense to me. I want to thank you, Alex, for opening my eyes and helping the blind to see. I want to be crazy, crazy like Alex Jones, and have enough gumption without a presumption to know what's going on. And I can throw bananas at the global clowns and hear aristocratic moans. I want to be crazy, crazy like Alex Jones.
Up, up, and away!
The talk show host is Alex Jones. He's a conspiracy theorist. He's kind of like the guru, the king of the conspiracy theorists.
The TSA has a thankless job enforcing procedures we all tolerate through gritted teeth, a popular target.
No kidding. Who else wants a job groping men, women, and children all day?
All the talking heads on the TV screen with an arrogant sophistication.
Challenge Alex Jones to a boxing match. Show up with a semi-automatic that you got legally and pop him.
I'd love to see that. In uniform.
1776 will commence again if you try to take our firearms.
I probably own more than 50 firearms. Many of them have increased in value 2, 3, or even 4 times. I sleep very comfortably.
One of the least attractive groups of demonstrators I've ever seen.
Then I can throw bananas at the global clowns and hear aristocratic
moans. I am David Mentelson.
Crazy like that.
Be quite clear, David Mentelson III.
Yeah, I wanna be crazy, crazy like Alex Jones.
We'll be right back in Overdrive. Infowars.com. See you this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. Central, Central, Central. Telemundo. Muchas gracias.
Now
that
Radio
is a funny
Network.
Intro right there. We're not actually going to break, though. We're still in this segment. That is the crazy like Alex Jones intro. Very good. I think Darren McGreen cut that. Lots of funny stuff looking back. Hey, it's good to be a little crazy, right? Who wants to be normal? And I'll tell you what. It's about to be Independence Day, you know, 4th of July. And it makes me wonder also, if you ask people what Independence Day is, if they'd even know what it is if you didn't say 4th of July. But you see, independence is a scary thing. It's independence from all forms of oppression and domination. And that doesn't just mean, you know, in a government sense. It means independence as in you're not depending on anything. Independence is scary. Independence of all forms, right? So independence from things like the social domination, the verbal domination we get every single day with political correctness. And that's one of the articles I'm going to talk about today, that poll, majority of Americans oppose political correctness and how they kind of asked it in a weird way. We're going to talk about real persecution instead of just fake political correctness where one gets upset. And that is gay men in Ivory Coast attacked for showing support to Orlando victims. So in Africa, 6 gay men in Ivory Coast were abused and forced to flee their homes after they showed some support for the Orlando attacks at Pulse. That was actual persecution. We're going to talk about the grand illusion that we're all under in some ways and how that ties into this. Mutilated bodies wash up on the Rio beach right before the Olympics, exactly where they're going to play volleyball. But everything's fine. You know, you think we might all be told some illusions as well. And then some weird news, too. Japanese porn industry says it's very sorry that actress was forced to have sex on camera, extorted. French beach police are now going to carry guns with their swimming trunks and bulletproof vests because of terror threats. And then we're going to talk about cannabis compounds could treat Alzheimer's by removing plaque-forming proteins from brain cells. And we're also going to talk about the truth about marijuana and how it has nothing to do with getting high in this sense. And then another weird one, too. Mounting evidence suggests hobbits were wiped out by modern humans. So, hey, Lord of the Rings was a true story, all right? Frodo was out there about 30,000 years ago. Apparently, hobbits did exist. But before that, and before we get into Apple, this new patent that could prevent illegal phone recording, so you're out at a public event or a concert or something, and it says, sorry, can't take a video. Something amazing happens, you know, asteroid coming down through the sky up. You're at a concert, can't take a picture or video. Just doesn't work. Of course, I've been talking about that for a long, long time, and now it's about to come. We'll be right back, and we are going to play a special report from Alex in the next segment. Stay tuned. All right, we're back. That's right. This is The Alex Jones Show, and I'm Anthony Gucciardi. And in this segment, Alex has shot a special report that has previously been unaired, and he's actually really excited about it. He came in and just reminded me, hey, make sure you play this because it's very important. Right now on InfoWarsStore.com, decided to launch the 4th of July sale before the weekend because, you know, it's the weekend, it's Friday at that point. Everyone's out doing things. It's hard to remember what you actually need. So at InfoWarsStore.com, you've got 20% off Survival Shield X2, 20 to 40% off of storable food, always worth it. 15-year storage life, so you can just put it in the garage or whatever. And water filters, 20% off. Air purifiers, 20% off. You see the theme, right? Independence. And like I said, independence not just from the government or whatever, but independence in your life, not depending on people for your basic needs. This is the starter kit, you could say, for total independence. Food, water, air, health. And now we're going to go ahead and go to this report by Alex right now.
"42 years ago, Dr. Henry Kissinger, the known war criminal, was Secretary of State in the Richard Milhouse Nixon administration. And he authored National Security Study Memorandum 200 that remained classified for several decades. In that memorandum, now publicly available, they talk about using food as a weapon and as a tool of social control. Not a new idea. The Romans had carried it out. So the Babylonians, the Egyptians, the ancient Chinese. It's known as siege. Control of food, control of water, you control a population. But his aim wasn't just to use it for control. His aim was to use it for depopulation, to ship the West toxic waste to the Third World. That was just one of the sickening ideas in the declassified portion of this memorandum. Fast forward to 1992 in the Rio de Janeiro Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro. There, globally, we saw the planet codify a plan to not push for expanding human wealth and expanding human success and expanding the living standard, but to reducing it and setting up a society based on making the people poor and setting up a global structure where having children is next to near impossible. That is the world we live in. If you go back to 2007, the British Ministry of Defense came out and echoed a Department of Defense report from here in the U.S. saying that beginning in the year 2016, right through 2020 to 2030, that they believe there would be massive multi-100% food price increases worldwide. And that during that global meltdown, that there would be incredible social unrest that would depopulate much of the earth. Now, in 2016, Vice magazine and other publications are reporting on a 2015 report produced by the U.S. government, the U.N., and scores of foreign nations, as well as the State Department, overseen by food giant Cargill, the World Bank, and most importantly, the World Wildlife Fund. The World Wildlife Fund is a eugenics anti-human organization set up by Prince Bernhard, who also founded the Bilderberg Group and who was a Nazi officer. He was also cousins and best friends with Prince Philip, Queen Elizabeth's husband, who says he liked to come back to the earth as a virus to kill 80% of the population. He also doesn't believe that Africans are people. This organization sells environmentalism to make the elite look like heroes saving the earth, when in truth, they are ushering in a planetary tyranny that is irrevocably damaging the fabric of our planet. In this new FEMA report, with headline, FEMA contractor predicts social unrest caused by 395% food price spikes, you learn that this is a report filed with governments and major institutions overseen by a contractor that since the 1940s has been the main advisor for the U.S. Navy Marine Corps.
The game itself created an opportunity to live into the future. It caused people to think through what the possibilities are. And in that process, I think they realized what they have to start to do today to prepare for that future.
The challenges and crises that we were assigned are exactly what we expect to see in the future. So you've got famine, you've got increased pests, you've got the role of climate change in the world.
It's a world where it's getting hotter and it's getting drier. We're also seeing increased social unrest because of the volatility in the food system.
Food prices are going up 400%. We've got a flood of migrants coming in. The world is starting to fall apart.
Everything we do is going to have some negative effect.
We are going to have a pretty hard world to live in.
The new normal is volatility.
You need to read the report and the articles about the report for yourself, because it fits in to the Defense Department report now from about 8 years ago, 9 years ago, and to the British report, where they're acting like, oh, this is terrible, but we believe this is coming from all of our experts. But the experts are the eugenicists at Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, and other major institutions that have been admittedly, artificially jacking up food prices worldwide, financing the Arab Spring, financing other revolutions to consolidate control. everywhere, whether it's Venezuela or Brazil, or whether it is areas of Spain or Greece or Italy, central banks, private banks, are installing presidents and prime ministers. They're threatening an EU military to take over eight nations that are trying to leave the euro who never even voted to enter it. We are seeing an iron curtain of tyranny descend, and it's the globalists that have been orchestrating a financial world meltdown that is triggered by a food meltdown. There are major studies you can look into that when 50% of someone's paycheck or a family's earnings each month goes towards food, civil unrest, riots, and destabilization are triggered. If you look back at major university studies that have analyzed from the public records what happened during the 10-year depression from 1929 until about 1939 or 1940, 7 million Americans starved to death or died from complications resulting from malnutrition. To be clear, upwards of 90% of the American population in the Great Depression lived in rural areas, and more than half of them were self-sufficient. Today, only 10% live in rural. We're 90% urban, and only half of the rural population is estimated to be self-sufficient. That is 5% of the population. Think about it. 7 million dead with more than half self-sufficient. What's going to happen when only 5% are self-sufficient? And in this report put out by the World Bank and the State Department, they talk about societal collapse due to this problem, from crop failure to system failure. But they're the ones managing the crisis that they've helped create. They're the ones that think they're going to ride this tiger to burn down society and have a global fund set up like the Marshall Plan after this meltdown and after the depopulation to basically control planetary development. All of their world government projects have been failing over and over and over again. They can't democratically get it done. England just left the euro or began the process because they never voted to enter it. It's unelected. The globalists that run it are tax exempt. The EU Parliament is ceremonial. And the people of England across the political spectrum have learned about this. They've learned that the globalists have fed on third world populations, enslaved them, absolutely poisoned them, weaponized crops against them, engaged in genetic engineering, engaged in secret testing, and much of it's been declassified. And now these giant hordes of poor, desperate people are being directed into the West, not to be empowered, but to bring the West down. This is the sabotage of the carbon taxes. This is the sabotage of the globalist program. This is the essence of what the New World Order is trying to do to society, to make you so poor and pathetic they can dictate the terms of your total surrender. Remember Obama a few years ago when he traveled to Africa? And he told aspiring Africans who were looking up to him as success, he said, you can't have air conditioning or a car.
If everybody's raising living standards to the point where everybody's got a car, and everybody's got air conditioning, and everybody's got a big house, well, the planet will boil over.
He should have said, we're going to develop cleaner cars and air conditioning, and out of these new innovations, we'll have the next generation of success. But that's what they teach Americans. It's what they teach Nigerians. It's what they teach Japanese. They're teaching everyone that you should just lay down and die. You should hate yourself. You should just turn your whole will over to them because you're an evil, dirty human that's poisoning the earth. And they know that once you industrialize a country, people have less than two children and population declines. But if you go back to the British Commission in 1949, they say, if we industrialize the third world, we'll empower them, and they won't have too many kids, but we won't control them because they'll have their own industrial base. We move to let them overpopulate, then use them as a political weapon, exploit them, and then use them to conquer the West once their populations balloon. This is a cold-blooded plan by the most wicked people the world could ever imagine. This is the ultimate divide-and-conquer great game. Play one side off against each other's system, and it's absolutely a threat to humanity.
Food riots now have killed yet another Venezuelan. According to Reuters, they're reporting that a man was shot dead on Tuesday during looting and food riots that were proliferating around the crisis hit Venezuela. That's according to an opposition legislator who issued that report, bringing it to at least a number of four. Four in the number of fatalities for this month's wave of unrest.
These were the chaotic scenes as residents of a city in southeastern Venezuela went on the rampage in search of basic food items. People desperate for staples like milk, rice and flour stormed a supermarket warehouse in Guayana City. A 21-year-old man was shot dead during the unrest.
As the government has reportedly neglected to pay the EBT benefits for 8 days. Michael Snyder of the Economic Blog reports, widespread reports continue to pour in from all over the nation of glitches with the food stamp system. It is 8 days into the month, and large numbers of people still have not received their benefits. And in other instances, it is being reported that EBT cards are simply not working correctly. Michael Snyder continues, on downdetector.com, there are scores of reports of problems with the EBT system from people all over the nation. Could this simply be another example of government incompetence, or is something else at work here?
Now, the big question is, what are we going to do about it? The advice I give you is the same advice that I carry out in my own personal life. Number one, everybody needs to be able to protect themselves. Everybody needs friends and family they can rely on in crises. And everyone needs high-quality storable foods and high-quality water filtration systems. Not just for collapse when it comes to water filters. All the garbage in our water, you'd be insane to drink well water or tap water with the glyphosates and all the rest of it. But we're offering the biggest wide-spectrum sale ever on preparedness items. 20. That's the lowest savings to 40% at InfoWarsStore.com. On InfoWars Select, high-quality storable foods, the highest quality, the lowest prices, powered by My Patriot Supply. We also sell their food as well, their full spectrum. And all of their water filtration systems across the board, from gravity-fed systems like Alexa Pure and Pro Pure, to shower filters, to survival straws, you name it, it's all 20 to 40% off right through July 4th at InfoWarsStore.com. And the profit that we make as well helps us in these times to continue our operation and expand it in the face of the globalists, because people are listening to what we're saying more than ever, because we've been proven right, because we've been reading their own documents, their own memorandums. The globalists are eugenicist technocrats. They're orchestrating a world meltdown to reduce population and bring in crisis and bring in control while they pose as the saviors and establish a world government on the ashes of our society. Everything they're doing is about making us dependent. That's why it's key to have a emergency plan for disasters. That's why it's key to have storable foods. That's why it's key to have water filtration and non-GMO seeds. We have it all. Shortwave radios, crank radios, solar panel systems, the very best preparedness items out there at the lowest prices. I was just in a meeting today with Weldon and others saying, I want you to continue to research the best products, and I want you to continue to buy in bulk and give people the lowest prices. And we sat there and compared our products even to Amazon. And in most cases, we beat them. That is unprecedented. So that's my commitment to you in a win-win. I'm selling products I personally use and that I know we need that make us independent, that I think you really need, and it also funds the tip of the spear in the fight against the globalist. So take advantage of this July 4th holiday special that runs right through next Monday of 20 to 40% off all preparedness items. But the water filters and the food is paramount. And look, you don't just need food for yourself. You need extra food to take care of friends and family and others that don't listen or didn't listen. And here's the good news. You can eat this insurance. This isn't like car insurance or fire insurance on your house that, you know, thank God you never have a wreck, your house never burns down, so you don't need it. This is insurance that lasts 25 years, that's super high quality. I've got storable foods I bought 10 years ago that last 20-something years. I just gave it to a homeless group. I've given storable foods to friends and family that are down and out. They're high quality. They're delicious. This is insurance that you 100% will be able to eat. And what's crazy about this is, finding a silver lining in that cloud, is that if they're looking at scenarios of 395% increases in food prices on average worldwide, I was saying 20, 30% might go up next year. If they're looking at something like that, Well, imagine buying storable food at the prices it is today. That blocks out the inflation we're starting to see in food that's rearing its head. And so you're able to save money if inflation kicks in down the road because you bought your high-quality, delicious storable foods at InfoWarsStore.com. I'm giving you the advice that I've taken. I've never bought this much storable food. I've never gone out and got this much water filtration systems or put in extra solar panels or generators here at the office. But I don't want to be dependent on the system because everything they're doing points towards an engineered collapse. Hopefully enough people get prepared and are ready so that we, the people that are the patriots, are informed, not just here in the U.S., but worldwide, can stand up and tell everybody, see, we told you so, and hopefully help folks around us and organize some type of political, economic resistance to this Agenda 21, Agenda 2030 globalist program. But regardless, as a father of three children, I'm doing everything I can to really get ready to protect my family into the future that's coming, because as I said earlier, this has gone from a possibility of collapse to a probability to more and more an inevitability. There's always hope, but as the Bedouins say, trust in God but tie up your camel. I know I personally am getting prepared. The warning signs are insane. I'm hoping for the best, but I'm preparing for the worst. Take advantage, 20 to 40% off until early next week with the 4th of July holiday special at InfoWarsStore.com.
That's right. Check out InfoWarsStore.com. 20% off X2, 20 to 40% off storable food, 20% off air and water filters. We'll be right back with more news. This is The Alex Jones Show. You know, we had a lot of special reports to play and intros and videos to play on this fourth hour. We didn't get a chance to cover much news, but we did talk about it. And the big news, of course, is that Apple is developing a patent, or has a patent, that could prevent filming of so-called illegal situations like concerts and what they deem to be classified areas, which is the beginning of something that is very, very disturbing. Because, you know, you can take your iPhone out, I do all the time, and take a quick video of something. How many YouTube videos have you seen that's just an iPhone video? Usually in the wrong aspect ratio, right? But that's something amazing. It's something very, very valuable for history or just whatever, finding out what happened. And this sets a precedent that deemed illegal, your phone just won't take video or photos. So we've hit on that a few times, but you can't hit on it enough because of how important it really is. Now, there's so much debate for no reason about marijuana. And whether it's, oh, could we have some health implications from it, or is it an evil, evil thing or whatever? But I'm going to settle that debate by saying all of the evidence that we're talking about, that I'm talking about in articles like this, have nothing to do with getting high. So this is an article. Cannabis compounds could treat Alzheimer's by removing plaque-forming proteins from brain cells, research suggests. Now, here's the key. This is, cannabis compounds can fight toxic proteins, which cause Alzheimer's disease, research has suggested. Now, cannabis compounds, what does that mean? Well, if you break down what is actually in marijuana, you find that something known as the cannabinoids, or cannabinoids, are really the crux of it. The THC, which is what makes you high, has a lot of beneficial properties too. But the actual cannabinoids, or cannabinoids, however you choose to pronounce it, is a lot of the health benefit, and those don't make you high. You could put that in a protein shake, and it's not going to make you high. It doesn't do anything. You could take that as a supplement. It doesn't make you high. And the quote from the researcher is, although other studies have offered evidence that cannabinoids might be neuroprotective against the symptoms of Alzheimer's, we believe our study is the first to demonstrate that cannabinoids affect both inflammation and amyloid beta accumulation in nerve cells. So it's not the high factor that is doing this. You could take these beneficial compounds from the marijuana itself, from the cannabis, right, and put it into something just like regular hemp. Hemp does not make you high if you're taking the non-THC form of hemp. So if you're making a protein shake with hemp, you're getting a lot of the benefits. Still can't make it in the United States. So there's no debate. There's no debate. Why should you not be able to get hemp that does not contain THC, doesn't make you high, doesn't make you paranoid or whatever they're going to say, right? It's not even making you high, and it's just loaded with health benefits. So in my view, the debate is completely over. What a joke on that. And you don't have to even smoke marijuana to get the benefits from that, right? So I'm not even advocating that. But back to this. So, you know, we see the majority of Americans oppose political correctness. I wanted to break down earlier what I was saying when I said this, that if they asked the question differently, it would be a huge difference as well. So Paul Watson wrote this article. He's always on top of stuff, just such a genius guy. A majority of Americans oppose the politically correct environment that many claim has chilled free speech, according to a new poll. Now, they asked people, which is closer to your point of view? There's too much political correctness today, or there's too much prejudice? I mean, there's still a lot of prejudice. It's kind of a loaded question. I still think political correctness is bad, but there is prejudice, right? So I can see why some people would say there's more prejudice, but guess what? 51% still said political correctness is even more prevalent than prejudice. People are tired of it. Told you for a long time, people are going to backlash against this big time. It's over. This establishment system of political correctness is failing. It's losing. The facade is falling down. Well, hey, thanks so much for joining the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Alex will be back tomorrow from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. Have a great Independence Day weekend also.